safety, these rules and officials are just trying to protect the players. And you'll see a lot of times you'll get the sky kick, try to get it to that second wave, the second line of players, and you'll get a big collision. So that rule will definitely implement another safety factor.
Well, Youngstown State, you see the veteran kicker, Zach Kennedy, a shot of him, the senior, who's going to be kicking off. There he is for Youngstown State. The Penguins will be sending it deep, perhaps, to Marcus Sims. We'll see. It's another factor, certainly in wet conditions and windy conditions, special teams.
Ball security will be very important today. We'll take a look at the operation between the quarterback and the center exchange. Special teams will be very important, especially on punt returns.
Well, Sims, number two in the Big 12, number 13 in the nation, averaging over 26 yards per return a year ago, and he will get a crack at it here. Retreating to his goal line. Crosses the 10, the 15, tripped up, and down he goes at the 15-yard line. Atavius Payne with a tackle for Youngstown State. And here's Will Greer, the Heisman hopeful. What a start he got off to. You mentioned some of the awards he won a week ago. Pretty much every national award had him as their player of the week, including, of course, the Big 12 Conference as well.
And I tell you what, this guy is something special. He can fit the ball into tight windows. Great anticipation. He sees things before it happens. Very special talent.
Greer will give to Sinkfield, and Sinkfield is taken down for a loss on the play, dropped by Sharif Bynum, who looked to be unblocked and stops him for a 4-yard loss.
Yeah, very good play behind the line of scrimmage. See that penetration up front. Defensive end coming down, making a play behind the line of scrimmage. Great start for Youngstown.
So Sinkfield out, Martel Petaway, the veteran junior, comes into the right of Greer. Second and long. Greer will give to Petaway on the draw. Finds some room. Petaway crosses the 25. Upended. Brought down by Avery Larkin. That's good news for Youngstown State fans. It bumped up a little bit in practice, banged up a little bit, and able to come out and make an early stop.
Well, if you're ever going to run a draw, this is exactly how you want it to look. You want to let that front line go ahead and get some pressure up the field, let that second level go ahead and fly out there, create some space, and that way you'll have room for your running backs. Great pickup by Petaway.
Third and a couple. Greer fakes, looks underneath, and it looks like it is complete to Sims. Hung on, tough coverage, first down West Virginia now, hurrying to the line of scrimmage.
You can see this tempo. Jake Spavital wanting to go fast, wanting to get these guys lathered up, get some plays under their belt. They'll go tempo from here.
Petaway off the right side. Petaway finds some room, bangs forward to the 34-yard line, a pickup of 8. Let's take a look at a couple of the players to watch for each team. David Sills, a preseason All-American, just like his quarterback in Will Greer, and Armand Delavade, tackling machine out of West Allegheny High School. Bob Palko, an excellent program at West Allegheny, and Delavade, one of the better defenders they've had go through that excellent program. And here on the second down carry is Petaway, and he picks up a first down out to the 38.
Well, you can see West Virginia early on trying to establish that running game. We mentioned the wet conditions. This is one way to take control of a football game, and that's being physical up front with this running game.
So continuing to go with a four-receiver set, but they've been running a lot out of that look. And Greer back. Looking. Going to throw deep. Has a man with some activity going downfield. Sims was bumped off of his route. You can hear the crowd perhaps booing. They thought it should have been interference.
A lot of times you'll get some incidental contact down the field. Not sure if the feet got tangled up right there or not. The fans are going to want the flag. You can see here on this replay, Greer just putting that ball a little too far to the outside, to the right. But again, I think that was incidental contact. And fans will always want that flag.
Now Larkin gave him a bit of a shove there, and now we have a penalty against West Virginia. As Yadni Kajust, wouldn't have mattered anyway, Yadni Kajust, the left tackle, called for a hold. So first and 20, back to the 28-yard line. 12:37 remaining, first quarter. Opening drive for the Mountaineers. Greer gives, and this is the freshman Sinkfield, and Sinkfield stays on his feet and gets out to the 36-yard line. So a determined run for the freshman Sinkfield, and Markel Blackwell, the new running back coach, has a dilemma on his hands, a good dilemma with four talented running backs as we see another flag on the play.
It's definitely a good situation for Coach Blackwell. You have four guys to choose from. So far, these running backs have been running very physical behind their pads and staying low. That's what you want.
The officials huddled up.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Defense number 7. 15-yard penalty will be added from the end of the from the dead ball spot. Automatic first down.
And that's Bryce Gibson, the second team preseason all-conference nominee.
I tell you what, in a game like today for Youngstown State, the last thing you want to do is give West Virginia breaks. If you're going to come in here and try to steal this victory, you're going to have to help yourself out. Personal fouls, self-inflicted penalties will not help you out.
Jerron Wesco, the tight end, is checked in an H-back formation to the right. And the give, and it's Sinkfield again, and Sinkfield is hit almost immediately. Armand Delevate in on the stop.
Now, one thing I'm noticing early, this front defensive line for Youngstown State, these guys are doing a pretty good job up front, getting some penetration right there. You had about two or three Youngstown States on the football at the first point of attack, so we'll see how this plays out. This offensive line for West Virginia is going to have to start to fire off the ball.
Third meeting between the two teams, the first in 1938, the second a couple of years ago, as we mentioned, a very close ball game. Now Greer has time, and now that time goes away, and he is brought down, sacked on the play. Wes Thompson came in, looked like he had pretty good protection, and then maybe held the ball a little too long, Rasheed?
A little too long, but 91. Let's not take away from what he did on that play. Gave second effort. That's Wesley Thompson. Not a big guy either, just 6'2", 90 out of Boardman, Ohio. Very good effort play by him.
So now another long situation for the Mountaineers, third and 13. Kennedy McCoy in motion. Greer back. Greer looking. And Greer completing. And he has Sills, and Sills makes one move, and now David Sills will lunge forward and pick up a first down.
This is exactly where David Sills can hurt you. If you let him catch a ball in the open field, Will Greer doing a great job of buying himself some extra time. But right here, you get the ball in the open field, Sills, he makes a guy miss, and he's able to pick up that first down. These guys, this receiving core is absolutely electric for West Virginia.
A big third and 13 conversion for the Mountaineers. Greer moves Pettaway to his right. Giovanni Haskins in tight, the tight end, to the left-hand side. And it's Pettaway off the left side, and Pettaway met by Delevate and others, but still picks up a solid 5 yards on first down.
It's been a very impressive drive by West Virginia. Started back at their own 15, still possessing the football. Again, I talked about that power from Pettaway and these West Virginia backs. Staying behind their pads, staying low, picking up positive yardage.
Second and 5. Take the Pettaway. Greer rolling, looking, lofting, and almost intercepted. I don't think he saw the free safety that was deep there. Lofted it, and Avery Larkin was there to break it up.
Well, this is one thing we talked about in the meetings. Will understanding that he doesn't need to make every play. Coach Dana Holgerson told us this year coming in, we talked to Will, let him know, understand you don't have to make every single play. Definitely threw that one into double coverage. He escaped. Could have been an interception.
Yeah, I think I just don't think he saw him. He had Will Crest breaking deep. Regardless, another third down here for the Mountaineers. Able to convert a couple so far to keep this drive alive. Now we have a flag coming in. And it's going to be against West Virginia. They call the timeout prior to the flag.
To the play clock expiring, West Virginia takes their first timeout of the half.
So with a timeout, the Mountaineers facing another third down, trying to keep this opening drive alive. Third and 5, 9:49 remaining, first quarter. Opening drive for the Mountaineers in their home opener, facing a third and 5-2 for two thus far on this drive on third down. Trips to the left for Greer. Takes to Petaway. Looking now, sliding to his left on the run. Looking downfield and has it intercepted, picked off. And Youngstown State comes up with a stop. And it's Will Latham, the nickelback, who comes up with the interception, first of the year, thrown by Greer.
What a protection was good for Greer. You get into a third and five situation, which is very manageable, so that's what you want if you're West Virginia. Will Greer had to escape outside of the pocket just a little bit, but you need to be careful with the throws. Again, we talked about the wet weather, not trying to force too much. You have to be careful with the football. He escaped one earlier. That time, Youngstown State doing a good job coming up with the interception. They take over.
And if you're Bo Pelini, you have to be delighted with that start. A couple of unforced errors by his team, including the post-snap penalty, kept the West Virginia drive alive, but they come up with a turnover, and now have Montgomery Van Gorder, the Notre Dame transfer at quarterback. He'll give to Tevin McCaster off the left side, gallops through a hole, spins to the outside, crosses the 40, lowers his shoulder out to the 45-yard line. Impressive opening play and run by Tevin McCaster.
Well, I knew this is what Youngstown State was going to try to do coming into this football game. Tennessee did a good job on the ground versus West Virginia. There was a lot of question marks about this run defense. And right now, Youngstown State trying to basically exploit what WVU has, what they do not have on defense.
Very banged up linebacker core, which we'll get to. Van Gorder fakes, throws, and to Shackelford, incomplete, and that was Josh Norwood jumping that route. The Mountaineers linebacking core already injured coming in. No Brendan Ferns, no Quandarius Qualls. They're hurt. They're hoping to get them back later. And then Charlie Benton, who is starting, as you see, an excellent play there by Norwood. Charlie Benton gets hurt 14 snaps into his career, and he's out for the season. So right now, West Virginia doing a little mixing and matching at that linebacking position.
Yeah, they took number 9, Javonte Stewart, and pulled him down into the box to help out.
Oh, my. Bigelow with some tremendous pressure. We saw it in the opening play last week against Tennessee, and the USC transfer swallowing up McCaster for a loss of 4.
Number 40, Kenny Bigelow, again, picking up where he left off last week in that Tennessee game. We saw that same exact play. This guy is an absolute force up front. And as a nose tackle, offenses will have to start to double team him if he begins to get too disruptive in that backfield. Great play by him.
Yeah, highly, highly touted player coming out of high school, 5-star recruit, rated number 6 in the nation. 2 major knee injuries, but Bigelow looks recovered and refreshed for the Mountaineers. Van Gorder will give on the draw. This is McCaster. McCaster hit from behind, dropped, and it's a gain of about 5 on the play, but will bring up a punting situation for the Penguins.
McCaster will be able to help Youngstown State out, but you want to be able to stay out of third and long situations, especially against this WVU defense on the back end. Good secondary guys, but that pass rush, you want to be able to get, if you're WVU, your front line guys to that quarterback, and it's going to be hard for Youngstown State to convert those third and tens.
Mark Schuler back in punt formation. It's a snap. Sims trying to angle for the ball. He's going to let it bounce, and it takes a terrific Youngstown State bounce. Can they get it? They can. There's a flag down on the play. It's down inside the 1-yard line. Let's see what the flag is. Well, that is a great job on special teams.
Very good job by that punt team from Youngstown State. We'll see what this penalty is, but where you're going to have a
holding,
long field to work
return
on.
Return team number 28. Half the distance to the goal. West Virginia's ball, first down, timeout.
I don't know how they can go half the distance from a foot away, but they will. Darius Hall downs it inside the 1. Dana Holgerson's team pinned deep after that 57-yard punt. We'll be right back.
With a lot of impact transfers coming to Morgantown, it's hard to believe that just a few months ago, USC transfer Kenny Bigelow Jr. thought his days as a football player were over after a couple of devastating knee injuries. But with the encouragement of friend and wide receiver David Sills and being granted a sixth year of eligibility, Bigelow is back on the field making plays. Bigelow said he can't lie. He was dreaming about being out there the night before the Tennessee game, and that certainly paid off. Bigelow came out, made the first tackle of the game, and Rashid, as you mentioned, it was originally recorded as a tackle for a loss, but thanks to the communications director, Mike Montoro, it was changed to a sack. Guys.
Thanks very much. And yeah, that was his very first play. That's what I love. It wasn't just an impact, immediate impact. TJ Simmons, the Alabama transfer, first touch goes 59 yards. Bigelow's first play, a sack and forced fumble.
Both of those guys made a big impact very early. Bigelow mentioned he thought his career was over as a player.
Here's Petaway off the left side and picks up about four more. And you have the Eastern Christian there in Delaware, and a lot of guys have come through this Mountaineer program that come from that school, including, as you heard Meg mention, Bigelow and Greer. So a lot of these guys knowing each other, passing on the tradition, and that's become Lackawanna. We're seeing that up in Pennsylvania, too.
That's right.
A good pipeline for the Mountaineers program.
That's such a good story. I mean, the guy said he was sleeping on his mom's couch, contemplate walking away from football, and here he is making plays out here.
Oh, here's Petaway, gaping hole through the right side. Martell Petaway is tripped up by Avery Larkin as he gets out to the 29-yard line, but the Mountaineers run the ball three times, pick up 28 yards, and pick up a first down.
I tell you what, if you're Petaway, these are the kind of holes you want. You get out, you see nothing but green in front of you. You get into that secondary. That's when those guys start to wear down. You can use that physical running style, running attack, and before you know it, third, fourth quarter, they're going to be wearing down.
Here's Kennedy McCoy, and Delavate able to stop him. I beg your pardon, Letty Brown, who drops Delavate for a three-yard, maybe a four-yard gain in the play. Delavate with a stop on Letty Brown, the freshman. We mentioned Sinkfield redshirt freshman Letty Brown, highly touted true freshman for the Mountaineers.
Well, how do you feel if you're Youngstown State? You get Petaway, and right after that, you get Letty Brown in there. Hard to stop.
And the draw play to Brown. And the big freshman rumbles out to the 45-yard line to pick up another first down for the Mountaineers. Pickup of 8 yards on the play.
And there it is. That's that 1-2 punch. West Virginia showing pass right here. They're able to get a lot of separation between that first and second line. Great play design, great draw. Again, Letty Brown is going to be a big contributor, big factor for WVU moving forward.
Yeah, make that a 12-yard gain, by the way, as a Youngstown State player down. Coach Bo Pelini coming out. We don't have a look at the number. We'll get the information for you when we resume. The Mountaineers marching, 5:48 remaining. First quarter in a scoreless game. Well, Cash Mitchell was the injured player, but he's back out there. So let's take a look at what happened here. Banged up as he came in from your right there to lay the hit on Letty Brown. And Mitchell was able to pop up, leave under his own power, and again back in the game now. Here's Letty Brown, the freshman, wiggling through a hole. Oh, my, banging through a would-be tackle. I believe it was Delavate who came up and hit him, one of the surest tacklers in FCS, and Letty Brown showing that strength.
Well, that's the physicality that I talked about from these West Virginia running backs. West Virginia showing 10 personnel. That's one running back, no tight ends, but they're trying to spread Youngstown State out. Letty Brown up the middle. That's 5'11", 211 pounds coming right at you. Very physical run by Brown.
14 yards, McGuigan hit him first, then Delavate, and he just kept going. And here he is again, right up the middle, and he's going to get a shorter gain. This time it's still a good, solid surge of 5 yards.
West Virginia's doing a good job on the ground. They're picking up positive yardage. Every now and again, Youngstown State will sneak a defensive lineman in that backfield and cause some confusion. But for the most part, that offensive line is getting a good surge up front, and West Virginia seeing positive yardage on the ground.
Kennedy McCoy has checked in for the first time, the junior running back from Lexington, North Carolina. And the fake to him. We're looking underneath, complete to Gary Jennings. Jennings shakes out of a tackle, down to the 21, another first down for the Mountaineers.
I tell you what, if you want a completion, you're going to throw the ball to number 12, Gary Jennings. The guy is an absolute machine when it comes to catching the football. Great underneath routes. He understands this offense, and he knows how to get open, and I think Will Greer knows that. Very good route, good execution by Greer and Jennings.
97 receptions a year ago. Amazing.
And only one touchdown.
Yeah, he had one last week, so put a down payment on that early as Sims gets inside the 10. That's Marcus Sims, another first down for the Mountaineers. Talked about those veterans, Sills, Sims, and Jennings. Earlier, 13-yard pickup.
Yeah, you're starting to see this offense come to life for West Virginia. Right there, just showing a little bit of misdirection, trying to get that second level from Youngstown State. Those linebackers to follow the flow. West Virginia came back with a basically an over route and was able to hit that right over middle, find Sims. Great job, at great execution.
Something that would have been almost unheard of for the Mountaineers. Two tight ends in the game. And here's Sinkfield off the right side, and Sinkfield will scamper in for the touchdown. The freshman, Alex Sinkfield, comes up with the TD.
This is what happens when you're throwing the ball well and you're running the football well. Youngstown State has no idea what's coming at them next. There was nothing special to that play, just an easy zone off to the right. You'll see Sinkfield just using his speed, getting to the corner. West Virginia jumps on the board.
First career touchdown, capping off a 10-play, 99-yard drive. About as close to 100 as you can get, because that ball was pinned inside the one. Evan Staley's extra point is up. It is good. And the Mountaineers on their second drive in the game, and the first career touchdown for Alex Sinkfield, capping off the 99-yard drive. They take a 7-0 lead. At Milan Pushkar Stadium, Alex Sinkfield, his first career touchdown around right end, a 9-yard scamper, and West Virginia up 7-0. Sure you remember your first touchdown? A great thrill, I'm sure, for Alex Sinkfield.
I tell you what, he's going to remember that for a long time. Now, first one is always special, and for the most part, it was a walk for him. He has great speed. Use that speed to get to the right corner of the end zone, and he walked in. That's going to be a very memorable touchdown for him.
Here's the kick. And the fair catch is going to be called for. We talked about that rule. So Christian Turner settles under it. And Youngstown State will get the ball to the 25-yard line as we take a look at an impressive 99-yard drive for the Mountaineers, and doing a lot of the damage on the ground.
A lot of damage on the ground, and that's the second long drive that West Virginia had. Right there, that one was very impressive, but we see the running game from West Virginia really taking over. They were able to get some things going, play action, get the eyes from the Youngstown State linebackers moving around, get them lost in the backfield. Then you come back with Alex Sinkfield using that speed, getting to the corner, getting on the board for West Virginia.
Opening drive for Youngstown State. They got a first down, then went three and out on the second possession. So looking to establish something here offensively. And now we have a whistle and a stop and play. Okay, so they'll wind it up and we'll start again. This already feels like an important drive. We talked about a pretty good start for Youngstown State, but the Mountaineers have made it look pretty easy in their two drives. It feels like Youngstown State probably needs to do something here early, as once again we have another stop. So they have to get a fresh football out there.
You're absolutely right, though, especially after that last drive. West Virginia took over, really looked in control. So right now the pressure is on Youngstown State to do something with this football. As I mentioned, the plan coming in, try to keep the ball out of Will Greer's hands. And right now, if they can't do anything on this drive, that offense is going to be right back out on the field.
Montgomery Van Gorder. Give. Good run by McCaster, who crosses the 30, gets out to the 31, and picks up 6 yards on first down, running behind a very experienced middle of that offensive line. Vitas Hrankowicz, the center, Connor Sharp, Gavin Wiggins, a crew with a lot of starts under their belts, particularly Hrankowicz and Wiggins, both preseason all-conferences, getting some preseason all-American accolades as well.
You know, one of the big question marks coming into the season was the run defense by WVU. We saw some four down linemen last week, which helped with that running game, trying to slow things down. So we'll keep an eye on four down linemen as this game plays out.
Oh, Jabril Robinson sniffed that out, Van Gorder on the keep, and Robinson drops him for the 6-yard loss. Robinson, the Clemson transfer.
That's nothing more than individual effort. Good vision by number 12, Jabril Robinson. Tony Gibson, defensive coordinator, said he plays very hard, extremely hard. If you turn on the film, one thing that's going to jump out to you is number 12 on defense, making a lot of plays with a very high motor. Great play by him.
Christian Turner, good receiving running back, has checked into the game. Van Gorder now with three left on the huddle clock, and I was going to have to call a timeout because he just could not get the team situated. And so on a 3rd and 10, Youngstown State calls a timeout. So last week, West Virginia, and we've seen, obviously just saw in this last play, the tackle for loss by Jabril Robinson, but this is something Tony Gibson wants, an aggressive team that can make tackles behind the line of scrimmage.
That's right, and that's that four-man line that I talked about. At times, West Virginia did it with just three down linemen, so that's very promising to see if you're a fan and a coach from West Virginia, getting a lot of penetration behind the line of scrimmage. The Seals brothers doing a great, Steels brothers, did a great job in that football game as well. So West Virginia has some depth at defensive line.
And there's Jabril Robinson. And, it is interesting that you have Josh Sills, right? And then you have David Sills, and then you have the Stills brothers. So
it's a lot of STs.
There's a lot of Sills and Stills. 3rd and 10. Now looking over to get the play changed, so Turner will move to the right of Van Gorder. Van Gorder back out in the flat and just threw it away. He knew he had nothing going there. David Long had sniffed out the swing pass to Turner, so it is 3 and out. The Mountaineers defense doing the job.
But that could have been worse than what it was. Being that Van Gorder is a senior quarterback for Youngstown State, understood the situation, didn't try to force anything, got the ball into the ground, and Youngstown State lives to play another play. But that could have been worse than what it was. You're going to have your punt team out here and try to pin this West Virginia offense back deep.
Well, Mark Schuler's first punt took a terrific roll. Great job of downing it. Now his second kick. And this will drive Marcus Sims back to his 30. Sims looking, not much room, and down he goes. 2-yard return to the 32-yard line, and that's where the Mountaineers will take over on their third offensive possession here of this first quarter.
So we talked about the pressure going back to that Youngstown State offense to do something with the football. Chew up some clock, just try to get some production going. But as I talked about, West Virginia's offense are going to be right back out there. One thing to combat that offensively for Youngstown State, you have to chew up some clock. The more opportunities you give West Virginia, and they wanted more series coming into this game. They had 10 last week. They want to be around 16. This is going to give them a prime opportunity to get those points on the board.
And the defense, obviously, the bigger question mark for the Mountaineers. Not too many question marks surrounding the offense. It's the defense that fans were concerned about, and so far, excellent performance against Tennessee and a strong start to this game. Here, looking, holding, underneath, complete. This is Kennedy McCoy, and McCoy will pick up a first down, an 11-yard gain out to the 43-yard line.
Well, that's one guy that you can't forget about. Kennedy McCoy had a promising year last year. A lot of people coming into this season thought he may be the guy, but he had some competition, and those other guys stepped up. But that's another running back that you can add into the factor for West Virginia. They're in great shape in the backfield.
Fumble last week didn't help his cause. Now the fake to him and a quick flip out to Simmons, and Simmons will pick up another 11 yards and another first down into Youngstown State territory and out to the 46-yard line.
Just to go back one play, we talked about Kennedy McCoy. His first touch last week was a touchdown. They hit him on a wheel route, had an opportunity to get into the end zone. But right there, Simmons, who also added into the factor with the big touchdown. These guys are loaded offensively, a lot of talent across the board.
And two hands around the ball here. Good hard run for Kennedy. McCoy hit early but keeps churning. Picks up five down to the 41-yard line. And it will be interesting. We talked to Jake Spavital, the offensive coordinator for West Virginia, and he said pressure's on these guys in practice. You have the best practice on and off the field the week. You know, what are you doing in the classroom? Are you showing up for everything on time? That's the person right now who's going to play.
It's going to be an all-around judgment. Class, performance from practice, week to week in the game. You have to bring your best effort every single time you get a chance to.
I mean, Jake Spavital, a really talented offensive coordinator.
False start. Offense, number 79. Five-yard penalty, second down.
Yeah, he has a very good offensive mind for a young coach. He's been around a lot of football, was a good high school player as well. But he understands. He's been under Dana. He's learned under Dana, been around some great quarterbacks. And Will continues that tradition of good quarterbacks that he's worked with.
Third penalty for 15 yards. Now Greer back looking, throws underneath, complete to Sills. Sills shakes out of a tackle. And another. It looked like he lost. Did he lose the football and get
dropped
it back?
Yep,
yeah, he did, and then got it back and first down.
Well, it's beginning to rain a little bit more here in Morgantown, and this was a good ball by, Will Greer. But if you're David Sills, you have to be able to tuck that football away in these conditions. Youngstown State, they understand it's just a little wet out here. They might be able to get that ball out. So if you're carrying that ball, you must protect it and put it away.
19-yard pickup. Here's McCoy, brought down by Delavade. Pickup of about four on that first down run. And we had a chance to talk to Jake Spavital about the ability to run, or last year really the inability to run. They want to be able to run effectively, and so far they're running effectively.
Yeah, and they're keeping it in control. Right now, Youngstown State very off balance. West Virginia's picking up some good chunk plays through the air, which is helping their ground game.
Now here comes a flag. And we have a false start on West Virginia, so that will be their fourth penalty.
Offense, number 73, five-yard penalty, second down.
So far been able to overcome these things, but again, you talk about the improvements week one to week two. You want to be able to make sure you don't have those types of penalties.
You don't want to take any steps back. You're right. Those are things that are very correctable. If you have execution issues, those are things that can really come into play.
Well, the Mountaineers have been dominating still. Only up 7-0, but it's Alex Sinkfield with a 9-yard touchdown run on the Mountaineers' second drive, their home opener. Now the clouds opening up, beginning to rain here in Morgantown. West Virginia up 7-0.
Well, guys, the rain is coming down hard here in Morgantown, but it is not going to stop the recognition of that 1988 team. And probably nobody better to remember the emotions of that year and that team than Don Nealon. He said that he remembers each and every one of them. He knows their moms and dads. He remembers exactly when he recruited them. Now, fast forward 30 years, and some Mountaineers fans will tell you that they believe this is probably the best Mountaineer team of all time. Dana Holgerson actually laughed and said that not only does he remember this team well because it'll be his 30th high school reunion, but he wore a West Virginia sweatshirt a lot of the times in school because of that team. Guys.
No, it's a great story, Meg. Thanks very much. First play of the second quarter goes to Kennedy McCoy, slithering his way down to the 25-yard line. Meg's got the tougher duty today. Pretty dry up here in the press box.
Feels good up here in the box. We're nice and dry. It's coming down out there. Starting to rain a little bit harder, but doesn't take away from doing your job. Meg is down there doing great.
And we see the first quarter stats, and it has been that dominant. One first down for Youngstown State, that's it. West Virginia marching up and down the field, 3-for-4 on third down. Want to keep this drive alive, though, because with all the marching, just 7 points so far. Greer back. Greer looking. Greer throwing and completing inside the 15, down to the 14 to Marcus Sims.
Well, the first thing that jumps out to me on this last play, you'll see here on the replay, first of all, the protection up front. Offensive line doing a great job of protecting Will Greer. But the time clock in his head, not to rush anything. He's very patient in the pocket, continuing to just survey the field, find any open receiver. Marcus Sims doing a good job in these wet conditions, cradling that football, picking up a nice big gainer right there. Another fresh set of downs for West Virginia.
8-for-10 on first down, and looks like Malik Richmond, the junior defensive end, down behind the play, being attended to on the turf here at Milan Pushkar Stadium. So they will attend to Richmond, and we will step aside with the Mountaineers a first and 10 and leading 7-0. Dana Holgerson's West Virginia Mountaineers ranked 14th in the country, leading Youngstown State 7-0, 14-21 remaining in the second. The Mountaineers picking up another first down, and now at the 13-yard line looking to add to their 7-0 lead. Give to Pettaway. Pettaway bounces to the left side, is able to step out of a would-be tackle and get down to about the 11-yard line. So Pettaway running hard, and the rain intermittent. I think we're going to see it on and off all day, and right now it has not slowed down this West Virginia attack at all.
Hasn't slowed down the attack, and the one thing I like out of West Virginia, they're showing a lot of variety, a lot of versatility within these offensive formations, a lot of 10 personnel, 11 and 12, and more use of the tight end. That's one thing that we talked about in the meetings. Expect to see more tight ends in this offense.
Wesco in at tight end, an H-back role right now. And the lead blocker for Pettaway. Pettaway bounces back to the left, and now Pettaway circles back to the right, looking for some blocks. Picks up one, picks up another inside the 15, stays on his feet, and gets back to about the original line of scrimmage. Ran about 60 yards to get there.
What a run. I mean, again, these backs for West Virginia, just so tough, so physical. You can see the second and third effort by Pettaway, reversing field, getting up, positive yardage, picking up some blocks along the way from the receivers on the outside. Great job, great individual effort. And again, those guys just lingering around for West Virginia, trying to help out as best as possible.
And they never did get him off his feet. Lenny Brown has checked in now on a third down. Rear back, looking, throwing, complete. And it is Jennings, and Jennings has already doubled his touchdown total from a year ago as he corrals his second of the season, and the Mountaineers up 13-0.
I tell you what, Gary Jennings, an absolute machine underneath. These intermediate routes, he understands what's going on. Right there, you see number three from Youngstown State. That's Cass Mitchell getting lost in a shuffle. Gary Jennings selling that sail route, going to the outside, letting the flow come with him. Right there, coming back underneath, and Will Greer understanding, holding onto that ball just a little bit longer, letting the route develop, finding Gary Jennings underneath. Great job.
And Staley's extra point attempt is up, and it's good. A 10-play, 68-yard drive, capped off on the 11-yard touchdown pass from Greer to Jennings. 14-0 Mountaineers. Three sweep coming up tomorrow.
Oh, Bucko's on a roll, back to 500.
They have got the makings of a really, really dynamite pitching staff. Forced to be reckoned with moving forward. And there, Christian Turner will call for the fair catch. And they will again take the ball out at the 25-yard line. So let's take a look at this last drive. Again, the first drive, Rashid, a lot of it happening on the ground. This drive, a lot of it happening through the air.
Yeah, West Virginia doing a great job. That protection up front, giving Will Greer tons of time to survey the field and hit his open receivers. These wet conditions has not slowed this offense down through the air. This vertical passing game is doing a great job. Right there, there's that touchdown we talked about, the patience. And Will Greer was pretty pumped after he completed that ball to Gary Jennings. You talked about it, already doubled his total from one to two touchdowns. And this guy's been absolutely on fire this season so far.
Yeah, 97 catches a year ago, only one of them finding pay dirt. But twice in the end zone already, once against Tennessee, once here against Youngstown State. And the Penguins right now facing, again, what seems a critical juncture in the game for them. Van Gorder flings one out, and Shackelford, did he catch it? No, incomplete. Darius Shackelford almost coming up with an excellent catch.
Yeah, so you'll see Shackelford manned up on that backside. That's Derek Pitts, number one.
Would have been a good catch, but as an old quarterback, I'm sure you'd like to see him brought that one in.
It's all about the completions as a quarterback. That's what you want, production, execution.
Second and 10. Van Gorder takes to McCaster, looks, throws underneath, and that one is complete to a sliding Zach Farrar out of the 39-yard line. And Farrar's a guy who started out at Oklahoma, four-star recruit, wound up at Mississippi Gulf Community College, and now here at Youngstown State, An excellent sliding grab and a first down, just the second first down for Youngstown State as that completion picks up 13 yards.
They're starting to pick up their pace a little bit. Get some plays rolled off. I think they're figuring out this defense from West Virginia. They're not doing anything special defensive-wise, coverage-wise, just a cover three, free safety in the middle of the field, so that middle field is closed.
Here's Turner now in the sweep, and Turner will bounce it outside, picks up an excellent block from Farrar, gets to the corner and down to the 41 of West Virginia.
Number 20, Christian Turner, again up front. This offensive line for Youngstown State starting to get it figured out. You see the guys on the perimeter making some blocks. And that's Turner just using his speed, able to get to the corner. 5'10", 195 pounds out of Cincinnati, Ohio.
20-yard pickup for the sophomore. And Woodard looks again. Lofting one downfield, and the flag on Pitts as Pitts and Farrar got tangled up, and so that'll be a third consecutive first down. Three plays, three first downs for Youngstown State, this one coming via the penalty.
Yeah, the refs will catch this one every time. Pitts just losing his footing and actually almost tackled the receiver.
Defense, number one.
Farrar selling it just a little bit more, making sure that the refs actually see it. And that's Pitts out of South Charleston. The refs will catch that one every time. Youngstown State slowly starting to get this groove going, getting this momentum going, try to get some points on the board.
Well, one more penalty for the same amount of yardage, 5 for 35 that they had last week in the entire game against Tennessee. So again, made mention of it. I'm sure that's something Dana Holgerson's want to see cleaned up. Van Gorder on the keep, and Van Gorder will scurry out of bounds inside the 20. They'll mark him out of bounds at the 19.
Nice pickup by Van Gorder. Not the most fleet of feet from a quarterback position, but, I mean, the guy has the tools to get it done on the ground. Right here we just see a easy play action. Not sure if that was an actual read for Van Gorder to keep it. But, again, positive yardage. I talked about the rhythm that West Virginia's in. Right now they seem a little off balance defensively.
We're looking, throwing on the out route, and almost intercepted by Pete Pitts. And, you know, Farrar was open for a minute, but the timing of that play appeared to be way off, Rasheed.
And our window was open for just a split second. And had Van Gorder let that ball go just a bit sooner, you're thrown to the near side of the field, which is very condensed. The cornerback is going to have time to recover right there. And right there, we saw Pitts able to get his hips around. Good ball skills by Pitts to make up on that.
There's Giovanni Stewart. You mentioned him dropping down, and normally a safety playing a little linebacker. Not a big guy, but very tenacious. 5'8", 195 pounds. Giovanni Stewart.
Some confusion from Youngstown State formation-wise.
They call the penalty there. 0-for-2 on third down, 0-for-3 on third down, I beg your pardon. And looking to pick up an important first down here as West Virginia up 14-0. Youngstown State trying to put some points on the board. Missouri Valley Football Conference preseason poll as Youngstown State picked fourth. This is probably the toughest conference in FCS. In fact, I think you could pretty much say it is. North Dakota State, perennial power, defending national champions. Youngstown State was in there a couple of years ago. Picked to finish fourth, North Dakota State number one, South Dakota State number three in the country right now in FCS. Important third down here for Youngstown State. And Gorder back looking, throws, and it is complete. Boy, Pitts got there at the same time as the ball, but Farrar, great concentration, able to make the grab.
Good concentration, and one thing that Youngstown State understands right now, they know they can go at number one Pitts. They're trying to pick on him a little bit. They got the pass interference right there. They had a third and medium. You could have kept the ball on the ground. They had a 10 personnel, just one back in the backfield. That's an easier play to call, but right now I think they're confident enough to know that they can go at number one Pitts and get some positive results out of it.
I think they like Farrar too, as we mentioned, again, a four-star recruit coming out of high school. So a lot of these guys Oh, my. They have to call another timeout here. Youngstown State, some confusion over on the sideline. You know, we were talking about this. Van Gorder is a guy that he was a Notre Dame recruit. Now, he hasn't played in a while. And again, some of these guys, it's going to take some of these pieces a while maybe to come together. Bo Pelini's team was a 5-touchdown favorite against Butler. A massive upset a week ago. But I think a lot of it is projection. Van Gorder, okay, he was a Notre Dame recruit, but he hasn't taken a meaningful snap in 5 years since he was in high school. And Farrar comes in, Oklahoma recruit, but, you know, transferring now, and he's new to the system as well.
Yeah, you can get some guys in there who has been at some bigger name schools, but as you mentioned, the experience, the actual game time experience is not there. So it's going to take time for those guys that chip away at the rest a little bit and just remember what it's like to be in true game action. So you have big names, big players, big schools behind them, but can they actually get it done when the clock has started?
Well, if fans watch, if they watch FBS and FCS, that might have been the most shocking score in week one, the fact that Butler, such a huge underdog, was able to win that game late. But Youngstown State's always played well under Bo Pelini against FBS teams, and now trying to cut this lead in half. There's a give. Oh my, as Turner walloped. Oh, he was absolutely drilled.
I tell you what, this is exactly what West Virginia linebackers practice from day to day in practice. That's number 11, David Long. Mountaineer fans are familiar with him. Very bright future at this school. That's how you come downhill and fill a gap. David Long with the solid hit between the tackles. Great job.
Loss of a couple. He was the fifth leading tackler in the Big 12 last year. Had 13 tackles a week ago against Tennessee. Van Gorder looking for the snap. Gets it. Throws. Lost. Corner of the end zone. And knocked away by Robinson, but flag comes in late. It was intended for Ryan Edmonds, but I believe this is going to be a penalty on Kenny Robinson.
Well, Youngstown State took a play out of West Virginia's playbook last week versus Tennessee.
Full 15 yards will be enforced to the 2-yard line. First and goal.
Well, the penalty is going to take the ball down to the 2-yard line and the pass interference call. 6 penalties now for the Mountaineers, more than they had a week ago against Tennessee. And again, Dana Holgorsen, some things that he's going to want his team to clean up, and now a first and goal from the 2-yard line.
Yeah, a lot of things to clean up for West Virginia on defense, but again, that last play, you get an outside receiver, you just run a simple hitch from that slot concept, you just run a fade.
Fade to McCasser, Van Gorder throws and knocked away, incomplete. Good coverage by Pitts that time as he gets the hand in there.
Yeah, it's been a battle with Pitts. He's being picked on a little bit, but right there, stepped up to the plate, did a good job. And you can see right there, he's telling those guys, bring it. I'm ready. I'm up for the challenge. That was a good job of getting that hand in there. May have got away with a little hand around
little
the waist on
tug.
Farrar, but sometimes the ref is not going to catch it, and it's going to be a battle in there. So good job by Pitts. Very promising to see.
Pitts, Norwood, Tony Gibson mentioned, full of confidence and a little vim and vigor from both those young men as well. And boy, the attempted give to McCaster goes awry, and it's Giovanni Stewart who comes in. It looked like maybe a little bit of a mishandle there, and it's going to be a loss of a couple.
Well, we talked about the wet conditions. That was the first center quarterback exchange problem. So you get a low snap, it's mishandled by Van Gorder. You just have to try to scoop it up and get what you can get.
So now, a promising situation, a little more tenuous here for Youngstown State. Third and goal now. They've backed up 2 yards to the 4. Van Gorder back, looking, heads to his left. Gonna pause, throw, complete touchdown as he throws late to Miles Joyner. He found the freshman a week ago, and he finds him again for another touchdown. Great patience by Montgomery Van Gorder.
That's very hard for the West Virginia defensive guys to cover. You get a play this close to the goal line, there's a lot of crossing routes happening. Your eyes are in different places. You see a quarterback who's scrambling outside of the pocket, and you think he's going to take off and run. You start to converge on that. Leave your man, and Van Gorder doing a good job keeping his eyes up, finding the open receiver to get Youngstown State on the board.
Well, they love Miles Joyner at Youngstown State, losing their top three tight ends from a year ago. But the redshirt freshman Joyner now two touchdowns in 2 weeks. Zach Kennedy, the veteran kicker, the senior, bangs it through. A 10-play, 75-yard drive, helped out by some West Virginia penalties, but finished off Van Gorder to Joyner to cut the lead to 7.
You have to take care of business today, but that'll be a tough game next week.
Zach Kennedy the kick, and then be taken by Sims at the 4. Sims wiggles through a little room and now stays on his feet and weaves his way out to the 29-yard line. Good return by Marcus Sims, one of the best in the country a year ago in Youngstown State. Look, West Virginia helped him out, but some impressive plays as well along the way.
The best drive by Youngstown State so far this game. They did a good job of getting plays, stringing them together, getting positive yardage, keeping West Virginia off balance defensively. And right here, toward the end of the drive, you see Van Gorder outside of the pocket, scrambling around a little bit, drawing up those defensive backs from West Virginia, dumping it off, finding Joyner in the end zone.
Jennings in motion. Give to Sinkfield. Sinkfield finds a hole, and man, does he hit a hole quickly.
Tell you what, when you're fresh, you have your teammates out there carrying some of the load for you, you can explode like that because you're not carrying each single ball every single time a run is being called your way. Here's that replay.
Well,
get that ankle caught underneath the pile.
Yep, reached immediately for the left ankle, is still down, being attended to. Each one of these backs brings a little something different. Letty Brown, the freshman, is just a straight sledgehammer. They talk about Sinkfield, that sort of one cut and go kind of guy. Pettaway maybe somewhere in between there. McCoy maybe the best receiver of that group. Really a diverse set of running backs for the offense for the Mountaineers to be able to employ every week.
I think Sinkfield may be the quickest, the fastest out of that group. As you mentioned, they all bring something different to the table. You get some physicality out of Brown and Pettaway, but Sinkfield can be your speed back. As we saw earlier, he was able to use that speed, get to the right corner of the end zone for WVU's first score. So I'm sure Dana and Jake Spavital hope he's okay.
You mentioned Coach Blackwell, the new running back coach. He had Kareem Hunt at Toledo, so he knows something about talented running backs. Obviously now with the Kansas City Chiefs, and oh boy, you don't like to see this.
Yeah, you're not able to put weight on that foot. That's never a good sign.
Heading very gingerly. They were extremely tempted to use him a year ago. They really liked what he was doing as a freshman. They were able to redshirt him. New rule, of course, now in which freshmen can play in 4 games and still hang on to that redshirt. Something we might talk about more as the game goes on. Interesting decisions for coaches, because the thought is, well, you know, fans might say, and we had this discussion with the coaches during our meetings on Thursday, hey, this is great, get him out there and play. Well, okay, but what if you burn up those 4 games earlier, then you need them later?
Right.
What if you use him now in a game like this? He hasn't played in 6 weeks, and all of a sudden you need to use him again. Well, now you do have to burn that red shirt. So
yes,
you're trying to juggle that a little bit.
Very precious situation. It's 4 games that you can get, but you have to pick and choose when you want to insert that player. So once you get him in there, you better be pretty determined that you're going to use him and play him.
2nd and very short. And you give to Letty Brown, and Brown barrels forward, gets out close to the 45. They're going to mark him down at the 44. A pickup of about 6 on that run means first down, West Virginia.
Now it's going to be very hard for Youngstown State to slow down this offense. If West Virginia can continue to pick up chunks of yardage on first down, get into second down where you're 2nd and short, possibly even 3rd and short, that's going to play into the favor of West Virginia.
Officials, as you can see, hustling around to try to get dry footballs into play. We're in trouble. Chased, rolling, throws downfield, and incomplete intended for Gary Jennings, but able to avoid the loss. And not a runner, but seems to have that good feel to keep plays alive.
He has escapability. You can see here on the replay, he gets outside of the pocket. You get a little bit of pressure, but just that shimmy right there, you get the defensive lineman thrown off his track a little bit, and that could have been a completion if you're not in these wet conditions possibly, but you see the escapability and able to keep the eyes down the field.
Second and 10. And the give up the middle and nothing doing. Dropped right at the line of scrimmage is Letty Brown. That was Sharif Bynum and others doing a nice job for Youngstown State.
Yeah, Bynum the first Penguin at the point of attack, but those are some of the plays that Youngstown State is making. They're getting some game tackles up front, a number of hats to the football. So, man, this defensive line, they're not going away. They're continuing to play hard.
This is a big play now with Youngstown State trying to gain a little momentum after that touchdown drive. Third and 10. Greer back, looking, slings, throws, batted away, incomplete. And it's going to bring up a fourth down. And that was, once again, Will Latham. We saw him with the interception earlier. Now steps in front of the post and knocks it away.
Yeah, this is a third and 10 situation for West Virginia. Again, protection is great, but that was just a good play in the open field by the nickelback, number 5, Will Latham, as you mentioned.
Yeah, really.
There's nothing you can take away from that.
And I called it a post, really an in route. And it's Jake Coates back deep. Billy Kinney ready to kick it away. Big pressure, and Kinney able to get it away, angling it towards the sideline, and it's going to take a good West Virginia roll and be down inside the 10, down at the 6-yard line. So Kinney, an excellent punt. We've seen each team get a little bit of a roll on that end of the field.
They must have leveled it out a little bit differently on that back end. You're getting some favorable rolls from these punters.
Do they still have that big crown in the field when you're playing here?
From my understanding, it's now flat. It's
but did field. They when you were playing?
When I was playing, yes, yes.
Yeah, they have flattened it out considerably. 49-yard punt there by Kinney. But, yeah, that's notorious for that big crown.
Yeah, you'll see that crown right at the 50.
Great work by our camera guys. You can see that
there
field's been leveled off.
First and 10 for Youngstown State. It's a very long field for Van Gorder and these Youngstown State Penguins to work on. Very important to understand your situation. You're backed up. You don't want to do anything stupid with the football. Protect it at all times.
Van Gorder gives to McCasper. Van Gorder out to the 15 and gets out to almost the 17-yard line. Well, I wasn't the only one fooled. West Virginia flowing with McCasper, and that allows Van Gorder to get to the edge.
Yeah, nice quick hands right there by Van Gorder, able to use some of that speed to get outside, but that's a nice good pickup for Youngstown State. Gives you a little more breathing room so you're not so far backed up. Now they can try to start to open things up a little bit more.
First down on that 10-yard run. Now McCasper will get the keep, and McCasper now bottled up as he crosses the 20, got out to about the 21, and oh boy, Alex Sinkfield being carted off, and you see a look of apparent concern in his eyes. That's not a good feeling.
Not a good sign. And one of the things that Jake Spavital talked about in the meeting was the running back battle is going to play out, and you hate to see it play out through injuries. You just want it to be a competitive battle, but it's just a part of the game. It's unfortunate.
Yep. Mark it at the 22. Van Gorder looking, and Van Gorder going to try to complete late. Are they going to say, nope, they're going to say St. Cern was out of bounds as he hauled that one in along the far sideline. Samuel St. Cern, yep, couldn't get the foot in. Youngstown State 2-for-4 on third down, trying to keep this drive alive. 6:02 remaining here, second quarter.
Well, this is a very crucial down right now for Youngstown State. You have a 3rd and 5 situation. You're backed up. You don't want to do anything stupid. For Van Gorder, take care of the football. Understand, don't try to force anything. Take what they give you.
Ball start. offense, number 20, was not set prior to the snap. 5-yard penalty, third down.
Well, we saw an unusual situation playing out there. A late substitution. Turner comes in for McCaster. Now West Virginia has the right to make their substitutions. And so because that came in late, Van Gorder was trying to hurry the team up, and Turner didn't have an opportunity to get set.
Yeah. Unfortunate for Youngstown State. Now you're backed up at 3rd and 10, which is really going to be tough. The crowd noise isn't that bad, but 3rd and 10, you still have to execute here.
Now, as you say that, the crowd understanding this is an important part here of this second quarter, beginning to make some noise. Van Gorder on the give. And this is McCaster, and McCaster's going to pick up a first down as he gets out to the 28-yard line. I beg your pardon, that was Turner on the carry.
Nice safe call by Youngstown State. If you don't get the third down, you're going to be able to punt it away, but nothing special to this play. You're just in a shotgun formation. You run an easy zone to the left. Turner using just that athletic ability to get upfield. First point of attack for the Mountaineers is about 6 yards down the field.
Van Gorder back, looking, time, now he'll tuck. And Van Gorder makes a move, gets out to the 40-yard line and picks up apparently another first down, depends upon the spot, but yep, they're gonna signal first down, 11-yard run for Van Gorder.
So everything I said about Van Gorder, you can throw it out the window. Great escapability right here, but outside of the pocket, you see a little nifty move right there, put on number 3, Toyus Avery. Left him in his tracks. But Youngstown State, again, just feeling out this offense, learning this defense, getting a little more comfortable with it. Doing a good job execution-wise here.
Clock rolling. Van Gorder keeps, and will pick up maybe a yard or so before wisely sliding at the feet of David Young. Or David Long, I beg your pardon. That's a guy whose feet I'd be sliding at. We saw that big hit earlier.
I'll tell you what, if number 11 is coming your way and it's just one-on-one, you better go down or he's going to run a hole right through you. David Long is a force to be reckoned with. Great player for WVU.
Pickup of a yard. Coaching 4.5 minutes remaining. Van Gorder on the give up the middle, and nothing doing as McCaster dropped by Dante Stills, the freshman, and we head downstairs to Meg Bulger. Meg.
Well, from nice and dry to the booth, the weather has drastically changed here. As you can see, it has really started coming down here. They are meticulously trying to clean off the footballs, keep them dry. Be interesting to see how this half finishes out and see if anything gets a little sloppy. Guys.
Meg, thanks very much. Good work down there on the sidelines. Weather definitely a factor now. 3rd and 11. Under 4 minutes remaining. Second quarter. Van Gorder back. Looking. Now moves to his left. Has to flip it out to McCaster and incomplete. Looked like he got a little antsy in the pocket there. And nice job covering downfield. And Youngstown State will be forced to punt it away.
I think he took off a little too soon. Didn't necessarily need to. The pressure wasn't really there. You get a little bit of pressure coming up the middle, but it's just a situation where you feel some pressure and you think it's time to go. Could have bought yourself about another second or two.
Mark Schuler back to punt. Marcus Sims back deep for West Virginia. West Virginia came after it hard. Schuler able to get it away, and Sims wants to return it. Sims bounces it outside, gets a couple of blocks. How about that? They had the block on, and Sims, with no blockers in front of him, able to make a couple of guys miss and pick up some positive yardage.
I'll tell you what, the most impressive thing here, he secures the football in these wet conditions, but picking up the blocks along the way, our punt team is very dangerous. You need to have your head on a swivel because, I'll tell you what, these guys are coming to knock your head off, and you're not ready. You're gonna catch one.
Well, that's a gutsy decision on a 10-yard return there because he knows the block is on, right? He knows he's not going to have a lot of guys there blocking for him. And is still able to pick up those 10 yards. Here's the gift to Petaway. Petaway picking his way forward, now steps out of a tackle and is able to lean forward out close to the 43-yard line. They'll give him 8 on that first down run.
Now, I think that's a really good point that you make to go back to that punt return, because from a strategy standpoint, a lot of people don't understand. If you're coming along with the block, you're not going to have guys on a perimeter block for you. So as a returner, you have to be smart. That was a big chance right there by
a lot of courage from Marcus Sims, and paid off on the good return. Now, after that 8-yard gain by Petaway, 2nd and 2. Quick out to Jennings. Jennings, first down, crosses midfield. Now to the 48 of Youngstown State. Clock stops as they move the chains. 2:47 remaining. Plenty of time for this explosive Mountaineers offense.
You'll see West Virginia go into a form of a two-minute offense here. They don't have to rush. They can attack the sidelines, use basically the sideline as a timeout saver.
It's Petaway spinning, and Petaway is brought down. Good open field tackle by Armand Delevate. Picked up a yard.
Now you still have your two-minute warning. No need to go fast or hurry with the tempo to get to the line of scrimmage. Just play it out. Make sure you get a good play called. If you're Will Greer, understand the situation. You don't want to force anything here. Keep control of the football. If force come to worst, you're going to try to get 3 points out of this.
2 timeouts left for the Mountaineers. McCoy, and McCoy will pick up about 3 down to the 44-yard line.
You know, one thing that I have not seen West Virginia do with these receivers that they like to do is throw a lot of hitches. The coverage on the outside by Youngstown State, the corner alignment, they're right at about 5 or 6 yards, so they're kind of sitting in that hitch zone.
Trips to the right of the formation. Rear back, pressure coming. And there's the hitch you wanted. Yep. And it's going to be a first down. So good call as Sims on the receiving end picks up a first down for the Mountaineers.
So Youngstown State showed a 2-high safety look, middle of the field open right before the snap. They rolled the corners back just a little bit, rolled the safety to the middle of the field when cover 3. So that's going to give you an extra 2 or 3 yards to work with. So from that 5 or 6 from the pre-snap alignment, now you get about 8 to 10 yards off.
Rear back, looking, firing, completing to Sims, and Sims out of bounds after a 9-yard pickup.
I'm sure the coaches from Youngstown State, the secondary coaches there, letting these guys know, listen, we want to give a little bit of cushion. Yes, we're in cover 3, but you don't want to give up 12 yards and just leave it wide open. West Virginia understands that right now, taking advantage. And you just might get a fade up top with a pressed-up corner.
Now that corner peeling back and rear. Looking, surveying, throwing corner out, man wide open, and it's Jennings again for another touchdown. 2nd of the game, this one from 24 yards out.
So we'll see on the replay here. Once again, protection just great up front. You have Gary Jennings in a slot, doing nothing special, just getting down, running an easy corner route. There's not a safety there to really attack, so I'm not sure if Youngstown State really lost him, but you put it on him in the open field. Will Greer understanding what's going on, where to go with the football. West Virginia back on the board.
Evan Staley, extra point up and good. A 7-play, 65-yard drive. Took him just over 2.5 minutes. Capped off on that 24-yard touchdown pass to Gary Jennings, the touchdown maker. Only 1 a year ago, 3 through 2 games thus far this season.
Well, he's mentioned in an interview, this year is going to be the year we're going to try to crank that up. You come out with 97 catches and only 1 touchdown a year ago, you want a little more touchdown production. But, I mean, the guy's an absolutely great wide receiver, as I mentioned, understands this offense, and most importantly, understands the defense as well. In this offense, you need to understand just a little bit of coverage-wise what's going on that back end in the secondary. So he understands it. He gets it. Very trustworthy wide receiver, and Greer knows that.
Greer now 13 of 17, 163 yards, two touchdowns, both of the Jennings. And it's always good to have that security blanket, that guy who knows how to run the routes, how to get open, how to move the chains. And this year, how to score touchdowns.
How to score touchdowns, that's right. I mean, you want to call him a possession receiver, but he's not a possession receiver because, for one, he can get behind defensive backs. He can take it downfield a little bit more. You think of a possession receiver, it's more intermediate, 8 to 10 yards, but he makes a killing across the board.
Here's Staley, the kick. And, ooh, Turner wants to return it, lost the football, and now in big trouble, and down he goes at the 16-yard line. So let's take a look at the Mountaineers' last drive. Defense comes up with a stop. A little bit on the ground and a little bit in the air for the Mountaineers on this drive.
Yeah, continue that physical running on the ground, but Will Greer getting it done through the air. You find Marcus Sims. We talked about that cushion from the Youngstown State cornerbacks. Then you come back with a big touchdown play. Gary Jennings just losing the safety, 29 for Youngstown State. Nowhere to be found. Great execution on that play. Good touchdown.
And you see what West Virginia has done. Just one punt on the day. Interception on the opening drive, and then three touchdowns. They've been able to move the ball virtually at will against Youngstown State, who is going to be flagged right now for delayed game. And Bo Pelini can't believe it.
Oh, you can see Van Gorder.
Delay game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Well, he's sure the clock wasn't properly set.
That's the signal Van Gorder was given, that the play clock was never reset.
Well, there's a new rule again to kind of speed things up 40 seconds after the kickoff, and they got out there and didn't get the play run. They want to pick up the pace a little bit. There's McCaster off the left side. Just a couple here. Wondered if West Virginia might consider using the timeouts with only two left so they can't get it all the way to the break. And you would think at this stage, Youngstown State happy to go in down the 14 points.
I mean, you're happy where you are if you're Youngstown State. You kept it somewhat close. And you want to stay in attack mode. You're not giving up just yet. You're only down 14, two touchdowns.
Give to McCaster, finds a hole, spins up to the 20-yard line, and 5 seconds remaining. That will be the final play here of the first half. So not perfect for West Virginia. Some penalties. They do have the one interception, but again, able to move the ball. The defense coming up with stops except for one drive and leading now 21-7. Let's head downstairs. I beg your pardon, Rashid. Let's go downstairs because Meg Bulger standing by with Dana Holgers.
Well, Coach, it's been a little bit of a mixed bag, both sides of the ball. This weather doesn't look like it's stopping anytime soon. What are your thoughts headed in the locker room?
Nothing that happened in this first half is surprising to me. I mean, we knew these guys were going to come out and play hard. You know, they always do. It's kind of what they are. And then after last week, we knew they're going to come out and play a lot better. So we've been expecting this, and then we're expecting this too. So it's good. It's good practice for us.
All right. Thanks, Coach. Good luck in the second half. Rob?
Meg, thanks very much. So as we head to the half, the Mountaineers up by the score of 21-7. A couple of touchdown passes from Will Greer to Gary Jennings. The first ever touchdown for Alex Sinkfield as well. The Mountaineers up 21-7. We'll be back with a halftime show on AT&T Sportsnet coming up next.
Just climb from out of that hole that you dug for yourself in the first half. You're down 14. It's just two touchdowns. You can make it happen.
Well, we saw that a couple of years ago when 14-14 at the half and Youngstown State hung around. And now here to begin the second half, Coach will take it a couple yards deep in the end zone and call the, well, they have the fair catch, right, the downing, all whatever it does, it gets the ball out to the 25-yard line now based on that new rule. And there's Montgomery Van Gorder, the Notre Dame transfer, getting set to lead the offense back out on the field. And again, Youngstown State, they have designs of pulling off an upset. And this is one of those teams that doesn't come in here trying to play close. They want to win the game. They're going to need some good early success here, you would think.
Yeah, you are. You're going to have to continue to take care of the football. And hopefully that halftime segment gave you some time to sit down and go over some things, work out some kinks, and make some adjustments.
Ben Gorder, back to pass, looking. They're going to throw one deep. He has Farrar out there and knocked away at the last minute. Norwood was able to get the hand up there. It looked like Farrar had him beat, but I think Norwood knocked that away.
He knocked it away. It was just slightly underthrown, but great makeup speed by number four, Josh Norwood, and he got that hand in there. And you can see Farrar, he turned around and had to come back to that ball just a little bit. So had Ben Gorder got that ball out a little bit further, that could have possibly been a touchdown.
No doubt about it. And Farrar has looked very impressive. You can see what Oklahoma liked about him coming out of high school. Second and 10. The option. Ben Gorder in trouble, and down he goes. Javonte Stewart, you mentioned him being moved up to occasionally play some linebacker, and now a flag comes in late. And that's going to go against Youngstown State as well.
Yeah, so it's not the drive that Youngstown State was looking for early on. And some just looked off about that play. It looked as if it should have been a play fake, but
holding offense, number 80. That penalty's declined. Third down.
And the penalty on Joyner declined, so it's going to be a third and long. And boy, you talk about a game of inches. Usually you hear that in reference to baseball, but if that opening pass is a few inches out there, and Farrar winds up with a touchdown, but instead now it's third and 13.
Yeah, football truly is a game of inches. Had you let that football go just a split second sooner, you're going to get another yard on it down the field.
The third and 13 now. 29 seconds is all that's elapsed here. And the clock now rolling. Opening drive of the second half. West Virginia showing blitz. Here they come. Van Gorder out in the flat. Oh, my. Nothing doing at all as Norwood came up and laid a hit. And it's going to be another loss on the play.
And that's Josh Norwood. Again, number four, the same guy that made the deflection down the field against number one Farrar, comes up with a big hit. The 5'10", 174-pound Richard Jr. out of Valdosta, Georgia. Big hit in the open field. Christian Turner's going to fill that one.
Mark Schuler wants to punt it to Sims, and now we have a flag and legal movement perhaps against Youngstown State. Let's see.
False start. Offense, number 35, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Bo Pelini wanted to know what number, 35 was the number. Schuler will try it again now with his heels in the end zone.
Perfect time to come after it.
Schuler probably thinking the same thing, quickly got rid of that, and Sims makes the catch and is hit immediately at the 29-yard line. Or I beg your pardon, the 49-yard line. And that is where Will Greer and company will take over their opening drive here of the second half after that 39-yard punt. And Will Greer, you see what he did in 2017. Remember, these numbers coming, despite the fact that he was hurt late, a preseason All-American, they began to get the Heisman hype going last week. 429 yards and 5 touchdowns. So career highs there. Numerous National Player of the Week honors as Letty Brown gets the first carry for the Mountaineers and picks up about 5. And we talked to Dana Holgorsen, and he said, you know, the Heisman hype, wonderful if you think the player can handle it. And he said Will Greer could handle it, so he's all for it.
Such a mature player. He's the son of a coach. I mean, the guy has a family. He understands what it's all about, so I don't think this hype will get to him at all.
Well, Letty Brown doing a nice job. Flags come flying in on what is for now a first down run. And then another flag comes flying in.
Flags on the play.
And Youngstown State indicating that they think it's against West Virginia. And the preliminary indication says it is against West Virginia.
You know, just to go back to Will Greer and talking about that Heisman hype, the guy has played a lot of football. He was at Florida.
Offense, number 58. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Replay second down.
It's Joe Brown.
Had the sit out, came to West Virginia, so he understands the process. He understands what it's all about. And it's not one that's going to get to his head and just let it blow up. So he's going to take this week by week. He understands what his job responsibility is, and has to come out here and lead this offense and execute it.
Second and 7. And Greer in the delayed draw. This is Letty Brown. Brown finds room. Brown finds a first down inside the 35 and down to the 33-yard line. Good run by Letty Brown. And just let's take one more look at this here before we comment on Greer again.
So West Virginia has made a killing on this play all night. You show draw, let those defensive backs and the linebackers fly out at her. You hand it off to Brown, and he picks up great yardage.
Greer stepping, firing, has a man. It's Jennings' third time. They have hooked up. This one from 33 yards, and the Mountaineers have scored on their opening possession of the second half.
If you're a defensive coordinator, you can't sleep at night. There's just too many guys out here to cover. There's too much talent across the board. You focus on Seals. You have Gary Jennings in the slot. He creates mismatches. That protection up front is great. You can see Will Greer looking off the safety to the left, coming back right. And Gary Jennings, again, just understanding how to get behind these defensive backs. That was number 19 for Youngstown State.
Now it took him just 4 plays and 1:11 to travel 51 yards. Third touchdown hookup to Gary Jennings, 33 yards from Will Greer. The Mountaineers go on top, 28-7. Well, we talked about those three receivers at the outset of the broadcast, Sims, Jennings, and Sills. And today I think you'd have to pick that guy in the middle, Gary Jennings, 3 touchdown receptions.
I tell you what, coming into this week, he talked about getting into the end zone a little bit more. I've raved about him. I like Gary Jennings. Last year, you talked about it, 97 catches. Absolutely amazing. And the 3 of those guys together, they're electric, great trio of receivers.
And here's the kickoff, and coach will call for the fair catch. It'll go out to the 25-yard line. And let's take a look, Rashid, at that last touchdown pass.
Yeah, so you can see from the wide copy, Youngstown State just playing a cover 4. 4 defensive backs across the board. Each guy is responsible for 1 quarter of the field. Gary Jennings just getting them behind number 19. Again, that's Crispin Lee. There's nothing special to it. No nods, no sticks or anything. He's right behind him. Will Greer doing a good job of just dropping that ball in and understanding the coverage from Youngstown State.
And Will Greer, 14 for 18, 196 yards and 3 touchdowns. Here's a give to McCaster. McCaster cuts back, didn't see a hole, and when he cut back, didn't see much either. Might have gotten a yard. David Long once again in there, as well as Jabril Robinson.
Well, this is what Youngstown State didn't want. West Virginia has now outstretched the lead. You're down for 3 scores. You're going to have to understand that this is a situation you need to feel the pressure, you need to get a sense of urgency, try to do something offensively that's going to give you a threat down the field to get some quick scores here. Still a lot of football to be played, though.
Yeah, we've talked about the important junctures in the game for Youngstown State. This appears to be another one as Farrar now loses the football, and it looked like Youngstown State got it back. Boy, Zach Farrar has been targeted extensively by Van Gorder, coughed it up, and Samuel St. Seren is able to recover for the Penguins.
Yeah, good awareness right here by St. Seren to pick up this loose ball and just squirted out from Farrar, but I've been watching him all night. He's a great route runner.
Well, you like 6'4", 205 if you're a quarterback as well, don't you?
Yeah, he gives you some range. He gives you a big target. The guy's a player.
Screen set up, McCaster is able to slither out, pick up of 8 to the 48-yard line. Josh Norwood trips him up there.
Norwood has played a pretty solid game for West Virginia. Came to life on that big deflection down the field. Just has his face in the mix of these plays. He's everywhere. He's around the ball a lot.
Well, Tony Gibson talks about Josh Norwood. His face lights up a little bit. Now pump and go, and Farrar, it's complete to him. Got past Norwood that time and down to the 11-yard line. So they missed on the big hookup earlier, but they come back with a long strike on this one.
But that's what offensive coordinator for Youngstown State, Brian Chris, understands. Josh Norwood, number four, is an aggressive guy. We can attack him with a double move. They've noticed that throughout the game, and now they've been waiting for the perfect setup to get him on a stop and go. The receiver did a great job of getting behind him, and if you're number four in blue, there's not much you can do right there. You just have an aggressive style of play.
40-yard hookup. Castor moves to the right. They've run out of this formation in the past. And they'll run it again. Castor looking. Castor trying to pick his way forward. And Castor is enveloped in a sea of blue.
This will be a prime opportunity here for Youngstown State. Your scoring position. You're doing what you do best, and that's keeping the ball on the ground. They have had some good vertical passing going on, but you go ahead, turn around, hand it off to your running backs behind you, let these guys go to work, try to pick up some good yardage.
Oh, if you're McCaskey, you must be wondering, how many guys do they have out there? Break one tackle, slip through another, and they just keep coming. Now fake to McCaskey. No, they'll give to McCaskey. McCaskey off the right side and into the end zone. Well, Tevin McCaskey on that read option, this time he gets the ball, keeps it, and goes in for the touchdown. And so Youngstown State, gut check time, able to come back and score.
Yeah, well, as I mentioned, the guy was a first-team all-conference a year ago. He can definitely run the football. Had a great week last week versus Butler. And here you just get some good blocking up front. You follow behind those big guys, and from there you just let your vision and your speed take over. You have a knack to find an end zone, the end zone as a running back, and right there it did a good job of it.
No scholarship offers coming out of Newcastle High
Hard
School.
Hard to believe.
And now closing in on 2,000 rushing yards for his career. Kennedy's extra point is up and good. And an impressive response. Six plays, 75 yards, just under 3 minutes, capped off by the McCaskey 13-yard touchdown run. Well, in the middle of your screen now, just obscured, Tevin McCaskey as he rushes in to complete that impressive drive for Youngstown State and cut the lead back again to 14. Mentioned this, Bo Pelini's team has always played in his 4 years their FBS opponents tough. 8 points to Pitt 3 years ago. We've talked a little bit about the game, but they led 14-7 in the second quarter here in Morgantown 2 years ago. Last year, Pitt needed overtime to beat them. And this year, hanging in there once again with West Virginia. Kennedy's kick very, very short, and Sims has to do a heck of a job just to come up and catch that. Remember, that's a live football. And so going to be pinned deep at the 18-yard line, and really nice drive here by Youngstown State.
Very nice drive. I talked about going into halftime, trying to get some strategies together, make some adjustments, figure out this West Virginia defense. And they came out on this second drive from halftime and did a good job, got into the end zone. So it's promising to see your players are taking their coaching. That's what you want to see as a coach.
And take a look at the drives here, put together by Youngstown State, and a couple touchdown drives. Not much other than those successful drives, as McCoy out to the left side, flag comes in late as he is upended at the 20-yard line. Pickup of two pending the outcome of the flag. But Youngstown State really hasn't gotten a lot going, but when they've gotten something going, they've been able to cash it in.
They have to be able to build on it, and I think that's a very key point that you made. You get something going, continue to build on it, and use that momentum to get back out on the field and pick up where you left off. You can't go one step forward and two steps back. It's going to kill you every time.
So a half the distance to the goal. Marched off here, so a 9-yard penalty is going to be a first and 19 for Will Greer and company. Eight penalties, 68 yards for West Virginia. There's Jennings to the 15-yard line. Brought down immediately, Armand Delavade, West Allegheny product, and in the tackle. He had that comment that Jake Spavital said that it's okay just to be average. It's okay to just make that short throw. Pick up 5 or 6 yards.
And that's the maturity you get with Will Greer. It's first and 19. A lot of quarterbacks will feel the pressure, feel as if you need to get everything back in one play, but you just chip away at it. You take what they give you, and you just be average and make a play.
He went over 200 with that completion. Now back looking, firing, completing to Sims, and Sims leans forward. Looks like it's going to be enough for a first down out to the 29-yard line.
Yeah, I tell you what, this is a fun offense to watch. From this viewpoint that we have, it's almost like watching 7-on-7. You get great protection up front. Will Greer is able to just sit back there. There's not a coverage on the collegiate level that's going to confuse him. So anything you throw at him, he's going to figure it out, and these receivers are smart enough to know where the open holes are.
13-yard hookup. I know you enjoyed your time at West Virginia. They get this one out to Tevin Bush, and Bush is able to scamper outside and get close to first down yardage. Late flag comes in, think we're going to give it an out-of-bounds hit here that should add 15 more on the play.
It's like a running back factory here at WVU. These guys just continue to roll through. And all of them are capable of being starters.
And now,
holding.
Yeah, no.
Offense number 88.
It's wrong. It's not a late hit. It's going to be again.
Spot of the foul. Replay first down.
Instead on West Virginia. I thought maybe that hit right there because that's where the flag came in. But that's not the infraction on this play.
Tevin Bush, such a versatile player. They can line him up at receiver, put him in a slot as an inside receiver, put him in a backfield, let him carry the ball. And he's another guy that's going to be a key piece of the puzzle to West Virginia as this season continues to play out.
Well, you know, the pressure to produce is high for all these guys.
Yep.
Here's McCoy up the middle. McCoy will get out to about the 33-yard line. But, you know, we're talking now. We don't know what the deal was with Alex Sinkfield and the ankle, but apparent ankle, but three running backs. Tevin Bush is battling for a little time as a running back, a little time as a receiver. You're trying to get packages involved for him, but if they don't work, they're just going to move on to the next guy because they have so much talent.
Yeah, and this is the deepest I've seen West Virginia at their skill positions in a long time. I mean, receiver, they're very rich. And this dates back to Geno Smith, Stetman Bailey, Tavon Austin, all those guys. They're very rich at the skill positions, that's for sure.
And Sharif Bynum did this in the opening play of the game, and now he is able to slant through and drop McCoy for a loss in the play. Brings up a 3rd and 9. West Virginia is 6 of 8 on third down. It's called 3rd and 8. Rear back. Has time, throws, man wide open, complete. This is Sims, crosses midfield. Sims weaves back to the 40-yard line and wrestled down at the 39. First down for Sims and the Mountaineers.
So I'll ask you this question. If you're a defensive coordinator, who do you key on? You can't key on Gary Jennings. You can't key on any running backs, because there's going to be another guy that's next in line that's going to hurt you. And Marcus Sims, I don't want to say he's the forgotten receiver, because he's not. He helps out in return game. But the guy is explosive. Probably, absolutely the fastest in that receiving core. But you can't forget about him because he makes big plays just like that one.
Rear back, looking, throwing. Has a man open, and Sills broke open, and Greer just overshot him.
You saw that a little bit last week versus Tennessee. Greer had a couple shots to hit some open receivers, but this is what I'm talking about, his anticipation. This ball is out of his hands before Sills even makes his break. He was a little flat on a break. I think Greer wanted him to take it more upfield toward that goalpost, so that's where the throw took it. But Will Greer was definitely thinking touchdown on that.
When you see these receivers running open and the way this offense is run, make you want to put the pads on and go out there and play a little quarterback?
Well, just like at the meeting, I told Coach Holgerson, you're going to have to deal with me running the football a little bit. I'm not going to stand back there like Will Greer and throw it around. I'm going to take off and run every now and again.
And here's McCoy taking off and running. And McCoy goes in from 39 yards out. Kennedy McCoy, I beg your pardon, that's Letty Brown. Letty Brown, the touchdown from 39 yards out. However, there is a flag on the play back at the 35-yard line. And the Mountaineers not celebrating anymore. They're heading back to their huddle.
Holding. Offense. Number 76. 10-yard penalty from the spot on the foul. Second down.
76, Chase Burnt called on the hold. The good thing about it, these are mistakes that you can correct. You get deep into the season, you get into that Big 12 schedule, you're in tough games, you're in shootouts. Those are the penalties that you don't want, because those points are definitely going to count.
Now McCoy has checked in for Letty Brown, who gets a breather after that touchdown run was called back. Weir loses the football and able to get it back. Well, West Virginia, 10 penalties for 88 yards. Now, as we take a look at this again, keep in mind, a touchdown just taken off the board. I understand what you're saying about learning experiences, but right now, if West Virginia can't convert here, Youngstown State got one touchdown drive aided by penalties. You're going to look back at penalties as potentially being costly here for West Virginia.
In a game like this, and West Virginia is not blowing this team out by any means, so penalty yardage, the hitting yardage will come into play in this game. Return, penalties, kickoff, punt returns.
Here's Greer looking, firing, completing. It's out to Simmons. It's going to be short of a first down. Looks like they're going to give him a pretty good spot down to about the 32-yard line, where it's going to bring up a fourth and three.
We talked to the coaches. Simmons is another guy that you cannot forget about. He's the fourth receiver, but he would be a starter in a four wide receiver look. So the guy's capable of being out there. West Virginia going a little more tight end lately, so you may not see him as much.
Fourth down, low snaps. Flung out there by Greer. And what a catch by Sims. Wave off the pass interference on defense, the defense for Youngstown State, because Sims able to come up with an acrobatic catch.
Absolutely amazing catch by Marcus Sims. I mean, it's almost like a video game. You get a low snap, Will Greer is witty enough to hurry up, get down, understands where to go with the football. Right there, the fact that he could pick that ball up, let it go, he knew where he was going with that football before the play even started.
Pass interference.
And then you have
defense, number 7.
Oh, my.
The penalty's declined.
Wow, with Gibson getting the hand in there. Not only the hand on Sims, but the hand that looked like it deflected the ball. That is such a difficult catch.
What a focus to be able to continue to keep your eyes on that ball. You have a defender's hand in there. That's a heck of a catch. You're not going to see any better receptions by that this season.
Yeah, it's not moving in slow motion like it is on our replay there, as Youngstown State now needs a timeout defensively. And so Will Greer and company trotting over after picking up that fourth down. The drive remains alive. They're up 28-14, 4:41 remaining in the third. We talked about the terrific trio receiving for the Mountaineers at the beginning of the broadcast, and Rashid, the numbers here today bearing that out.
I'll tell you what, David Sills, he's going to have games like this. Coming off the season that he had a year ago, 18 touchdowns, led the nation. It's going to be up to some other guys to be able to help out. Gary Jennings, huge night tonight, 3 touchdowns, 6 catches, 97 yards. And then you have Marcus Sims again. I told you, you cannot forget about him. 119 yards on the night. These guys get it done.
Power formation. The pair of tight ends in. We give to Letty Brown, and Letty Brown able to shake a couple tacklers and get inside the one. He was hit almost immediately by Savon Smith, able to shrug that off and get inside the 1 yard line.
Well, two things. Imagine tackling this guy in high school just a year ago, running the same way he does right now. And these are collegiate guys who can't bring him down. But the second effort, the guy has not been in a program. He hasn't had an offseason with the strength coaches just the summer. And he's running so physical. He's going to be a very good player here.
11 rushes, 79 yards. Give him 80 on his 12th carry and the touchdown for Letty Brown. That's the first rushing touchdown in the career of freshman Letty Brown.
I tell you what, Letty Brown deserves to get that touchdown. Very physical run to play before. I talked about it. But you get your first touchdown, it's always memorable. You're going to be able to run that highlight tape with the play before and this one together. No cut-ups needed. You just let it run. Here's my first touchdown. Hopefully plenty more to come.
And the extra point up And it is good from Evan Staley, and the Mountaineers have extended their lead to 35-14. A couple of freshmen with first. Singfield, his first touchdown rush. And now Letty Brown, his first touchdown run as well. Mountaineers up 35-14. The Mountaineers are ranked 14th in a good place, but that should not be a surprise. Four first-round picks since 2012. They continue to go to bowl games 15 times in the last 17 years. And they are continuing to upgrade the facilities. $50 million in upgrades here. We talked to Shane Lyons, the athletic director here, about the $100 million in upgrades happening to the Olympic sports facilities. Must be proud about what's going on at your alma mater. The turtling out of the 20-yard line was Christian Turner.
I walked around a little bit Thursday after our meeting, and I thought it was nice way back in the day when I was here. I mean, this place is state-of-the-art, phenomenal. They just redid the cafeteria where the players eat. It's like a collegiate dining hall just for the football players, though. That's the thing. So with the new rule with the NCAA, they can feed the guys around the clock. You give them a snack. It's just so first class, and that's what's going to attract the recruits to continue this program heading in the right direction.
Yep, and all the upgrades to the Olympic facilities just shows the commitment the university has as well. Thrown out and intercepted. Well, a late throw to the sideline is picked off. The Mountaineers come up with their first turnover of the game. And that's Trayvon Askew-Henry.
Well, you're trying to fit in a very tight throw to the sideline. You're late with the throw. Trayvon Askew-Henry doing a good job getting underneath of it. If you're Van Gorder, you're going to go back to the film and understand from this throw, if you're throwing from the middle of the field to the sideline, that throw is going to have to get out of your hands quick because you're running out of real estate over there on that sideline. But let's not take anything away from number six. Askew-Henry getting underneath of it. Undercutting that football, interception in the books.
Fifth career interception for the Aliquippa product. There's a handoff. This is Kennedy McCoy. McCoy weaving his way inside the 10 and down to the 8-yard line. 26-yard run for Kennedy McCoy.
You get number six on defense making a play. You come right back, number six on offense making a play. Right now it's just the spirit living in number six jersey right now. So it's good to see Kennedy McCoy in there. We talked about him coming into this game. A lot of people thought he was going to be the guy coming in for this season.
Another carry and another touchdown for the Mountaineers on the ground. Three by air, three on the ground, three different backs. It's McCoy this time. And the Mountaineers up 41-14.
Now I think back to the meeting that we had, and Coach Babatall talked about it's a very friendly competition between these guys. So just to be able to see these guys out here score touchdowns, they're smiling, enjoying this game, congratulating one another, picking them up, it's always good to see. So you don't want your guys fighting amongst each other for playing time. It's just a friendly competition, as he mentioned.
Competing but not fighting each other. Right? You want to see the competition as Staley boots it through to make it 42-14. But the Mountaineers getting three different guys scoring touchdowns on the ground, and then three receptions by Gary Jennings. And the Mountaineers up 42-14 as we head downstairs to Meg Baldrum. Meg.
Yeah, well, Rob, as this running game gets going, we saw running back Alex Singfield get carted off there late in the first half. An update on him, it is a left leg injury, probable not returning tonight. It was a left leg injury, though, and he will not return. Guys?
All right, Meg, thanks very much. And you certainly hope he's going to return later in the year. Redshirted a year ago, Dana Holgorsen has talked about the temptation to use him. They are so high on him. And we have seen in, you know, his few carries the burst and the reason why West Virginia is so high on him. Meanwhile, the other running back's doing a nice job tonight as well.
Yeah, I think Singfield is the fastest of these running backs. You have a great group of guys, but you get in the open field, you see the difference with Singfield, his explosion, his burst, his quickness, and gets north and south pretty quickly.
And here's the boot. taken by Coates. Coates was able to squirm his way forward to only about the 16-yard line. And that's where Youngstown State will take over after that 14-yard return. I talked to the chance to talk to, you know, ex-players, former college players, and talking to one in particular, David Walker, who's a running back coach after his career and was splitting time at Syracuse, I think maybe a little before your time, with Terry Richardson. I asked him, you know, was that hard? He said, you know, both guys deserve to play. And so that's when you have that sort of attitude, and if the attitude is, I'm sure these guys see that all four running backs are talented. They all should be playing.
It's going to take more than one guy. That's what it boils down to. So for a person to be selfish, think that it's just them and only them, they're wrong. Because for one, you have injuries. Two, you have fatigue factor. You're going to need a spell out sometimes. And if you're a team player, if you're a good teammate, let your teammate get in there. You cheer him on. You do the same exact thing and wish for the same things that he's going to want for you. And that's just good production.
Van Gorder over the middle, incomplete. Kenny Robinson in coverage and pass to Mallory, incomplete, but I think they're going to get Mallory over the back, or I beg your pardon, Robinson over the back of Mallory.
Pass interference, defense number 11, spot foul, automatic first down.
They called out on David Long,
David
number
Long's
11.
Like me? I didn't do anything. Yeah,
so
David Long's
definitely
nowhere near that. It is Robinson. 11 penalties, now 103 yards. Norwood at the top, and then, ooh, that at the bottom. Yeah, how long did we say? Incomplete.
Yeah, that's number two, Kenny Robinson, the free safety out of Wilkinsburg, Imani Christian High School.
And Gorder throwing, and complete, good hard hit by Washington, but not before Farrar picks up 18 yards on that hookup.
This has been what Farrar has done all game. He's making good catches, solidifying the football, make sure it's tucked away. We did see the one earlier, let it squirt out a little bit, but overall, this guy's had a solid game.
Yeah, they may have found something with Zach Farrar. And we're looking now, we'll move Tevin McCaster to his right. And Gorder, pump and go. Wants to go deep to Farrar again, and Farrar is able to make the grab again in his hip pocket over the top of Norwood. Similar move to the long play from before, a little hitch and go.
6'4", 205 pounds out of South Lake, Texas. Zach Farrar, you'll see him at the top of the screen. That's just a sluggo. Slant and go. You catch number four, Norwood from West Virginia, sleeping on that slant. And the offensive coordinator from Youngstown State understands that, took a shot at Norwood and completed it.
43 yards down to the 11. Give to McCaster. McCaster cuts back to the left, flag comes in. He gets down to the 7-yard line, pick up a four, but we have a flag in the play. Officials appear rather animated.
Personal foul, illegal block below the waist. Offense number five. It's a 15-yard penalty, replay first down.
It's the tight end Chris Durkin, who's been battling some injury issues. Yep. Oh,
yeah. Yep, that was number five coming across the formation, Chris Durkin. And that's a dangerous block. That's what you don't want to see, is going directly at the knee, and luckily that foot wasn't planted into the surface. That could have ended ugly.
And trying to keep player safety front of mind. Going to have to get all the way down to the 2-yard line. So it's first and 25. Low snap, Van Gorder looking, now moving out to his left. Looking and going to loft one out of bounds. once again seemed to get a little antsy in that pocket, didn't he?
He did, and I'm happy this play actually happened for people at home to understand how hard it is for a right-handed quarterback to try to roll to his left, get the shoulders around to make a throw down the field. You can see Van Gorder, he just wanted to get those shoulders around, but the pressure forced him to continue to the sideline, just had to eat it and throw it away.
That was Dante Stills, the number one recruit in the state of West Virginia. His brother Darius and the team, dad Gary, was a star at West Virginia, played in the NFL. Now a design quarterback draw and nowhere to go. Derek Pitts closing quickly and dropping Van Gorder for a loss in the play.
Great job by Pitts right there coming up from that cornerback position. That open field tackle. I saw this guy playing in high school. Just a tremendous athlete. And again, here's that open field tackle that I talked about. He was able to shed the block, make the play behind the line of scrimmage. Very solid play by him.
Now Farrar is the lone receiver split to the right. He has been Van Gorder's favorite target. They have to get down to the 2-yard line to pick up a first down. So it's third and 27. And they're going to loft one for Farrar, but Farrar wasn't running a go. He read something differently, and it's incomplete. And fourth and 27 now with 7 seconds left in the third. And they will send out Zach Kennedy and the field goal team.
And I was definitely a miscommunication. You saw Zach Farrar's hands go up, trying to figure out what's going on. He's communicating with the sideline. The ball went deep. He stopped short.
45-yard attempt here for Kennedy, who missed a couple of field goals in that shocking upset loss to Butler last week for the Penguins. This kick is up. It's got the leg. And it's got the accuracy. It's good. So a 45-yard field goal for Zach Kennedy with 1 second remaining in the third quarter. It is 42-17.
Nice distance on that field goal. That's pretty good. For coaches, you want to be able to see that. You don't know. He trots out there. If the week before he had a long field goal, you're going to be a little more confident to call it. But at times, there's going to become a point where you have to get him out there and understand where his range is at in true game action. So at least they know now where his range is. And if they need a long field goal, they'll be able to get it.
Well, we talked about Rasheed Marshall maybe wanting to play in this Dana Holgorsen, Zach Spavadal, the offense, or Jake Spavadal offense, looking at Rasheed Marshall here as the player. Rasheed Marshall, athletic dive to the end zone. Excellent career, clearly, at West Virginia, and I'm sure you remember all of this with great fondness. Of course, drafted in the NFL, a little work as a receiver and a return man. Hard to give up the quarterback position.
I tell you what, very promising career. I was just a kid wanting to play football. That's what it boiled down to. It was a long road getting here. I stopped at prep school on the way, came here, found myself a starting quarterback spot. And from there, I didn't want to let it go. Freshman year, got injured, came back, started 3 years in a row. So to be able to look back and see some of those highlights, it brings a smile to my face. But it's good to, just relive it a little bit. As a player, you don't get an opportunity to.
Here's Pettaway on the kickoff return. Pettaway reverses field, crosses the 40, and gets out near midfield on the final play of the third quarter. Pettaway, a big gain on special teams, and he will set up the Mountaineers with good field position when the fourth quarter picks up. And when we resume, the Mountaineers, 3 by air to Gary Jennings, 3 on the ground, including this one, the first of the career of Letty Brown, and this one from Kennedy and McCoy to lead 42-17. And the Mountaineers scoring output has increased every quarter. 7, 14, 21, and now Martell Pettaway, who had that great return. 10-yard gain on first down in the first play of the fourth quarter.
You hope to see West Virginia being able to carry this running game through the rest of the season. We understand it's the game of football. There's going to be injuries. But to be able to control the line of scrimmage the way this offensive line has tonight, with the way these running backs have been running the football tonight, that's a very good thing to see as a player, as a coach. Gives you confidence moving forward.
And that is, I believe, Crispin Lee, who's down. It's like perhaps a cramp.
Where they're kind of going to work on that. The Mountaineers able to run the ball effectively, pass the ball effectively, and leading 42-17 with a chance to add more here early in the fourth. There is an Ohio State Buckeye connection to this game. Gordon Gee, the president of West Virginia University, was president for a while when Jim Tressel, the president of Youngstown State University, was the Ohio State football coach. Their paths crossing, and now presidents of the universities playing today. And there is Dominique Maiden, and Maiden inside the 10, inside the 5, and Dominique Maiden goes in for the score. Well, a lot of excitement for Dominique Maiden, as you can tell, his first career touchdown.
Well, Dominique Maiden is a long way from home, that's for sure. Riverside City Community College out of California. But this just shows you what a great running game will do for you. Suck those linebackers in, just an easy play fake. Will Greer keeping his eyes up, able to find Maiden just coming across the formation, and he does the rest. Good execution.
Well, they're going to get him for unsportsmanlike conduct. Couldn't hear. Microphone didn't appear to be on. I wasn't sure if it was sort of an excessive celebration or what the call was, but Dominique Maiden, how about that? First career touchdown. Yeah, Jake Spavadal gives him a big hug. And you know, you love to see the teammates happy for the other teammate who worked hard in practice, and coming up with his first collegiate touchdown. Extra point kick by Staley is up and good. Two plays, 50 yards is the way the fourth quarter begins. In just 23 seconds, the Mountaineers have added to their lead. Come 49-17 is Will Greer's fourth touchdown pass and the first career reception for a touchdown for Dominique Maiden.
The Mountaineers really starting to have some fun here tonight as Dominic Jennings just scored his first touchdown. When I tell you, the entire sideline cleared out, sprinted down to the end zone to greet him, welcome him, everyone smiling. And I can tell you what, just after that timeout, it is still going on. They are still celebrating. So a bunch of happy Mountaineers down here right now, Rob.
You know, Meg, we're talking about the same thing. Dominic Maiden is still smiling. We were talking about it during the break that he's still getting congratulations. And out to about the 35-yard line. Hard banging hit there. And the return looked like Natavius Payne on the return there.
You're getting a lot of firsts tonight, that's for sure. A lot of guys getting into the end zone for the first time at home, which is great because it's in front of your home fans. Hopefully you have family here who's able to witness it as well.
There's two of the guys right there, Maiden and Letty Brown, each scoring their first career touchdown.
That's what they're probably talking about.
Well, Maiden's talking about it. He still looks like he's pretty happy. Good for him. Hey, listen.
The guy won't sleep tonight.
Oh, I don't blame him. McCaster on the run. Cuts back to the left, steps out of a tackle. Here goes McCaster. Crosses midfield. And Toyus Avery wrestles him down as he gets down to the 46-yard line. So a pickup of 19 yards for Tevin McCaster.
Yeah, this is where you start to see some defense. It's starting to fall asleep a little bit. Guys aren't as crisp in their assignment. Right there, you get a cutback across the formation. And McCaster, that vision of his is something else. I mean, he sees the holes. He understands where guys are lined up. Nice solid run.
McCaster again. Had to break a tackle in the backfield, and a flag comes in late as West Virginia doing a nice job stringing that out.
You know, a lot of times, late in a game, West Virginia, they understand that this game is pretty much in the bag. I talked about how solid
Holden
guys can be.
Offense, number 80, 10-yard penalty, replay first down.
It's much different in the first quarter where you need to be solid within your assignment. These are still the starters out here. They understand, again, that this game is over, so they might let up a little bit. They might give up a big play, but as a coach, you want to be able to see these guys play a full game. So I can promise you this defensive unit, we'll hear about that last or two plays ago once that film study goes on and this game pops up.
The hold there on Miles Joyner, and just for conditioning aspect, is that why you want to see the team play all four quarters?
Well, knowing that.
Here's Van Quarter. Sorry, I asked your question there. Just that ball's about to be snapped. Pick up a yard out to the 46.
Not every single game is going to be a blowout. You're not going to be able to take out your first teamers. Once the season gets pushed into the season a little bit later, these guys are going to have to play a full game. So the discipline has to be there through four quarters. Yes, this game is pretty much in the bag, but you can't let up mentally.
I see. So part of it maybe is physical conditioning, but it's also along with that staying sharp as the game gets later.
Exactly.
You maybe get a little
fatigued.
A second and 18. Van Quarter loses the handle, and Van Quarter is taken down for a loss on the play. And that, once again, the outstanding freshman prospect, Dante Stills, talking to Tony Gibson. Tony Gibson said, look, there's a long way to go, but he might be one of the best they've ever had coming through West Virginia. He's that talented.
Yeah, and those are some very, very high words coming from Tony Gibson, who's the defensive coordinator here. He's been around a lot of players. He's seen a lot of players come and go, defensive linemen, linebackers, you name it. But, again, that's the highest praise you can get from the defensive coordinator as a freshman.
Third and 24. Van Quarter back. Pump fakes. Throws. Deep. Nobody home. Intercepted one hand. Oh, my. Did that pop up out of the hands of Kenny Robinson?
I think it did.
Oh, my God. I want another look at this. Natavius Payne somehow came down with his ball.
So you have.
Well, it hit the ground. Payne came up with it. Yeah, the Mountaineers are going to want to look at this. Clearly off the ground. Payne alertly scoops it up, but. Thought Robinson had it there. Thought he came down with it, but then it popped back up. So that should be an incomplete pass as they take a look at this.
Kenny Robinson going up, trying to just get that left hand to secure that football. The ball definitely contacts the ground, but it squirts out right at the end. So that should come back.
Yep. Well, you mentioned Kenny Robinson, Wilkinsburg. You know, a lot of players from the Pittsburgh area, you chose to come down here. You had other scholarship offers.
Had other scholarship offers, Wisconsin, Kansas State, Maryland. But West Virginia was the place for me. I think it came down to Wisconsin and West Virginia. Brooks Bollinger was the quarterback at Wisconsin at the time. Ron Dane, running back. They were getting ready for the Rose Bowl when I took my visit there. And I knew at that moment I was coming to West Virginia.
One more look at it here as the officials continue to look things over, and West Virginia's defense is already popping back up the field. They think this 54-yarder is coming back, and again, everybody's moving the chains, and that's going to be the call. It looks like this is going to come back.
Yeah, I don't think there's any way that play can stand.
After reviewing the play, the ball hit the ground. It's an incomplete pass. It's going to be fourth down and 24 at the 40-yard line.
As we suspected. So, you know, a lot of Pittsburgh area kids, Drayvon Askew, Henry, we've mentioned, you know, quite a few times tonight. Others, obviously, on this team have decided to make the move down here to West Virginia.
Well, it feels like home. You get a lot of guys, and I hate to start rattling off names because I'll leave a guy out and get a text message about it. But for Western PA guys that come down, it's very close to home. Your family, your friends can come down and see you play. You get to play on national, regional television. It's just a good fit.
And Jennings able to make the fair catch back at the 22-yard line. That's where West Virginia will take over when we resume. The Mountaineers in firm command of this game, up 49-17. Here's a 2018 Heisman watch, and as you take a look at these numbers at home, hard not to like what Will Grier has done through 2 weeks.
761 yards in two games, 9 touchdowns. That's, I mean, he would be the leader of the pack at this point from a statistical standpoint.
46 out of 60, and Jake Allison has come in to replace Will Grier. And we heard Dana Holgerson talking about it with us earlier this week. He said, let's face it, it's in many ways it's a team award, as the handoff here to Letty Brown. off the left side. He'll get out to about the 26-yard line, pickup of about four. If your team doesn't do well, you're probably not going to win the Heisman.
Yeah, you're going to have good team production if you want to be able to stand out in that race. And wins is a big part of it. You can't be on a losing team and try to stick around in that race.
Hand off again. And Brown again banging his way through, staying on his feet to the 40. And now a big scrum pushes him out to the 44-yard line. Lenny Brown, hard physical running.
You know, I'm glad we get a chance to see number 11, the backup quarterback, Jack Allison. Coach Babbitt, I'll talk about him in a meeting, saying he came back out of the offseason with just a new learning experience. And he flipped the switch and turned it on. Very impressed from the coaches with how he stepped his game up coming into this fall camp. And they were very happy with what they came away from Jack Allison on that preseason.
Another player going down with the cramp here for Youngstown State. Brown, by the way, not only his first touchdown, his first 100-yard rushing game, as he has 14 carries now for 102 yards. You know, you mentioned Jack Allison, and he was a guy that ESPN ranked as the 68th best player in the country. He was figured as a four-star recruit by everybody, a top 10 quarterback in the country. Went to Miami, didn't work out for him, so he's transferred here. And with that light switch going off, no one's doubted his talent. I mean, I just sort of gave you a thumbnail of what others have thought about his talent. Boy, if you can get him a little bit of game action, hopefully Will Greer stays healthy. That was obviously an issue at the end of last year.
Yep.
But, you know, you could have an awfully good guy waiting in the wings. And they like Trey Lowe, the true freshman, quite a bit as well.
Right, and that's what it's all about. Competition. You want a good competition at each quarterback so that guy is being pushed. But I think if he's patient, gets some good playing time, he could be the next guy in line that's going to fill in.
And there's the handoff is Brown. Oh, my. Just hard, strong running by Lenny Brown.
Again, you're getting an opportunity to see what fresh backs can do for you. Yes, it's the fourth quarter, but these guys have not shouldered the whole load throughout this game. It's been a number of different guys. So if you can continue to keep these guys healthy, continue to split up these carries, this running game is going to be absolutely amazing for West Virginia late in the season.
Freshman congratulating freshman there. Allison's first career throw. And Maiden looked like he was kind of jostling downfield with Melvin Jackson, the freshman, and no call there. So just slightly overthrown.
Yeah, not sure if he got hung up there or actually stopped on a route, but there was definitely a hitch in the route there. So couldn't see it on a replay, but something looked a little off about that play.
Allison now on a second and 10. Give to Kennedy McCoy. McCoy bursting up through the middle. McCoy down to the 20-yard line before he is brought down by Melvin Jackson.
Well, a couple plays ago, we saw Lenny Brown carry it. What do? You go ahead, put Kennedy McCoy in there, set that draw up, let those guys fly out of there, let those defensive linemen get upfield, and you turn number six loose. McCoy doing a good job picking up positive yardage. West Virginia continuing to push this drive.
Again, off the left side. Not much doing that time. Pick up just a few.
Now, you talked about the differences that these backs bring to the table. McCoy showing a lot of patience behind the line of scrimmage. He almost like a Le'Veon Bell, Pittsburgh Steeler running back type of style, if you will. Picks his holes. He's slower, let the play develop, and then he's going to try to hit it. A little bit different from Petaway, Sinkfield, Lenny Brown, more power, just hitting the hole.
Allison back, looking underneath, complete. And that is Giovanni Haskins, the tight end, going across the formation down to the 14-yard line. We haven't been able to say completion to tight end very often here in West Virginia, but they really like Wesco. They really like Haskins. They've got a couple of freshmen that have come in, including another guy from the Pittsburgh area in E.J. Banks, who they really like. So The tight end, I think, is here to stay as part of the West Virginia offense.
Just allows for more flexibility for West Virginia. You can switch up that personnel. As I mentioned, you go 12, get one back, two tight ends, two twin receivers out there. Just gives defenses another formation to prepare for it. These coaches from West Virginia are smart. They're going to utilize it and just use up that time that these other schools have on the clock to prepare for something else.
So Will Crest, they're a former highly touted quarterback recruit who has switched to wide receiver. And by the way, David Sills, same thing, right? He was offered a scholarship by Lane Kiffin when he was in seventh grade,
seventh grade. That
amazing.
Is right. Seventh grade.
And then left the West Virginia program because he still had the quarterback itch and then returned and looks like a bright future, a bright present and a bright future at that position for Sills. Here's Evan Staley, 31-yard field goal attempt. It is up. It is good, and the Mountaineers add their lead up 52-17, 8:37 remaining between the Mountaineers and a 2-0 record. Well, the Mountaineer band has been busy. The mascot has had to do 52 push-ups, the Mountain Man, but many more times than that, right? You got to do them 7, and then you got to do 14, and then 21, and so on it goes.
He's going to wake up tomorrow pretty sore in the chest area, that's for sure.
You look like that'd be a walk in the park for you. Nothing to
do. That's just a warm-up for me. I get out there, that's going to be a warm-up. Then we play the next game, and that'll be the actual workout for me. It's a lot of push-ups.
And good to see the band in action. And I know that as players, you probably love the support of the band and the student body. All a big part of college football.
Yeah, we talked about the band a little bit. They put in a lot of work. We would come over from camp. They would already be out in the parking lot getting into formation. So they put in a lot of work. They support us. We support them.
Yep. Fair catch call for it goes out to the 25-yard line. So just academic now.
Still seeing a lot of starters from West Virginia's defense still out on the field.
Yep. We're going to see Adam Hensley's out there now, and some other guys maybe seeing a little more playing time. The Stills brothers out on the defensive line along with Jeffrey Pooler. Not that we're not used to seeing some of those guys in action. We are. Shea Campbell as well. Hand off to McCastrio, pick up a couple out to the 27-yard line.
This is good for West Virginia's second team guys, as well as the coaches, because again, you're going to have to see what you have as this season goes forward. Some of these younger guys, you get them in there, practice is completely different than what the game entails. So can you put them out there? Can you trust them? Can they complete their assignment as they did in practice, as they were coached up to do? So this is a good test for those second team guys.
Give to McCaster again, lowers his shoulder. Hensley in the stop, just talked about him. And Josh Chandler, another guy that we expect to see. So, and this is a mix right now. We really haven't seen a lot of guys that I think they just want to get their feet wet. Allison being the exception at the quarterback position. These are guys that are going to be counted on to, you know, we've talked about this. Injuries unfortunately happen. Things happen along the way where you're going to need guys to be ready. So you're trying to balance that with that four-game redshirt rule as well.
That's it. It's more to readiness than anything because you never know when a guy is going to go down. You're one play away as a backup from getting into that game.
Now that is really close and apparently just short of a first down there for Christian Turner. They're going to say he was brought down short of the 35-yard line.
28, Keith Washington coming up, laying the hit on Turner. Very solid.
In a good spot. He was definitely short. And they're going to line up to go for it here on fourth down. Now why not? Got to keep the clock moving.
Yeah, nothing to lose if you're Youngstown State. If you're on West Virginia's, watch for the hard count.
And kept by Van Gorder, and Van Gorder able to serpentine his way out to the 38-yard line and pick up the first down.
You know, I know it's late in the game, 6 minutes to play, but on the play before, you had Washington coming up making a hit on Turner, which was a helmet-to-helmet hit. I think early in the game, the refs see that They go back, they look at it. That was a very solid helmet-to-helmet hit, that slip pass. And again, I think early in the game, refs see that, they go back and take a look at it.
Yeah, the player's safety is moved to the front burner at every level of football. Here's Turner off the left side, wriggles through a hole, and picks up about four out to the 43-yard line.
This is a learning experience for Youngstown State. They'll be able to get into conference play, play some more evenly matched teams. They've seen success in the past. You talked about Bo Pelini. Basically, this team takes on his personality. They're going to get into that conference, play some scrappy football, some tough football. So this is not the end of the road for Youngstown State.
No, and they have got a really, really difficult schedule as Van Gorder. Quick pitch out, complete, and a first down. So they're able to move the chains as we take a look at Youngstown State's upcoming schedule. And a couple of ranked opponents still on the way here. So this is by no means an easy schedule.
Yeah, something about the FCF level, or excuse me, FCS level in the state of Dakota.
Yeah.
You have South Dakota State, North Dakota State sitting at number two and number one. So those guys get it done at that level of football.
Run off the right side and a yard or so pick up there by Turner. Well, then you've got the Colonial is the other league that's really stepped forward. That's the Missouri Valley Football Conference in the Colonial on the FCS level with James Madison and other schools. And meanwhile, for West Virginia, obviously the Big 12 Conference. So that game at North Carolina State really looming large. The schedule appears to be backloaded. You never know when you get into the conference, but boy, if you can defeat a Tennessee and an NC State, that's going to get people's attention. Already has. You're number 14 in the country.
And you're going to know what you have going into conference play more than anything. You handle Tennessee, you come back, you knock off Youngstown State, but NC State will be a good test for you. They somewhat struggled against Jay Madison. JMU did a good job of keeping it somewhat close. NC State came away with the victory, but it'll be a nice test on the road for West Virginia.
Yeah, they took it to Georgia State today, 41-7 in that game. Dana Holgerson going to be happy to see his team go to 2-0. Youngstown State, one of those teams, again, we talked about it. We saw it here a couple years ago. Mentioned their close games against Pitt overtime a year ago. Certainly no pushover. Under 3.5 remaining on this snap. Van Gorder pitches it out, complete, first down. And once again, that's Jake Cummings, who caught a pass earlier. So he mentioned, you know, first and second team guys. Cummings a little further down on the depth chart for Youngstown State in the wide receiver department, but able to come up with a catch there. And again, you're looking for things. You're looking for, if you're Bo Pelini, you're looking for fight from your team. Did you continue to compete? And they may have found a real star in Zach Ferrar, a wide receiver.
I completely agree. I mean, the guy's an absolute player. He uses his size. He understands body placement. He's able to set himself up. And he has solid hands. You didn't see a lot of drops by him.
Meanwhile, Josh Chandler, another stop. He has acquitted himself well here in some time late in this game.
You know, one thing that I think you mentioned that's very key for Bo Pelini's team from Youngstown State is the quit. They're going to turn this film on. They're going to watch which one of these guys quit. Can we replace him? If so, get him out, get another guy in there, because you're going to run into games where it's going to be tight. You're going to have to chew and scratch and claw through the whole game. You can't give up.
Flag on the play.
Yeah, we have a flag and a little quick movement there on Youngstown State. The Penguins just trying to run out the rest of the clock here and head on back to Youngstown. You know, Bo Pelini really thought he had a terrific team heading into the season, and the apple cart a little upset with that shocking loss. You got a 37-point favorite to Butler, losing in week one. You know, it was interesting the way that game transpired. Youngstown State had some touchdowns, callbacks, and missed field goals. And then they stopped the two-point conversion. But then there's the onside kick. And Butler went for the win right there. The two-point conversion didn't get it. If they kicked the extra point, who knows what happens in overtime. But you don't get that. Then you recover the onside kick and kick the field goal to win it. So that was a strange ending to that game, a game that Bo Pelini said, hey, I'm completely embarrassed about what happened. And, you know, Butler, a huge underdog. And, you know, hopefully for his team, they can take some positives out of this and, as you said, get ready and restart it for the rest of their recalibrated, maybe to say, for the rest of their season.
Well, as a coach, you don't want to communicate this with your team because you don't want them to become accustomed of just going out and laying down and accepting losses. But it happened so early in the season, first game, you can rebound from that. You can come back, bounce back. It's a long season. Yes, you're going to start off 0-2, but you can turn that around, flip the switch, and go on a string of runs where you're getting some wins here. So, as I mentioned, not the end of the road for Youngstown State this early in the season.
Hey, Gorder throws it out there and dropped. And the classic run before you catch it. And again, learning experiences all the way around. That was Colby Cooper, who is unable to come away with that.
Yep, you have to secure it before you turn up the field and run with that football. So both sides will be able to turn on the film, make a lot of corrections across the board from each position, and get better next week.
Third down, give to Turner. Turner will get to about the 40-yard line. How do you work on some coffin corner type kicking with a punting team? Do you keep the offense out there and just try to run out the rest of the clock here? Looks like they're going to keep the offense out at least for now. And maybe potentially take a penalty or call a timeout right around the 1 minute mark is when the play clock will expire. I'm not sure if they called the timeout or just let it expire. Looks like they just let it expire. Yep. So they're going to say 54 seconds.
Youngstown State. I wasn't quite sure the strategy there. Let it run down, call a timeout.
I just think that they are eager to see zeros up on the clock. And signaling maybe across the field, too, because sometimes you see that's important, too. I mean, there are times you see that more on the high school level, right, where teams don't want their second-teamers maybe going against the other team's first team. They want seconds against seconds. So even if you're losing a game, if you keep your first team out there, another coach may say, I don't want my seconds out there. I don't want my kids to get hurt.
Yeah, you
talk about player safety.
You want
to
protect your players, exactly.
Probably less of a factor in a game like this. As Schuler back to punt. Sills and Jennings back to the Mountaineers. I'll say this much, Youngstown State has done an incredible job of covering a couple of punts tonight.
Solid job on the punting from that unit on that end of the field for Youngstown State.
Right.
Very solid job tonight. Bright spot.
Well, that takes the kneel down out of the equation.
Yeah, you're going to have to run it, get a surge up front. You can see Jake Spavital telling his quarterback, Allison, make sure you get the snap if we go under center here. But knowing this offense, they'll still be in the shotgun regardless of the field position.
It appears to be the case. Well, that's it. Appears as if that will be the last play of the game. Yep, Bo Pelini already striding across the field, making sure that everything is taken care of, and that will do it. And the Mountaineers improved to 2-0. Impressive victory. Look, this is a talented Youngstown State team, and West Virginia able to take care of him and improve to 2-0 in the season and one more game prior to stepping into Big 12 conference play.
Gives you a little more confidence leading into week 3 versus NC State. There's going to be things that you can correct. There's going to be a lot of coaching points, but as a player, you have to be able to walk away from this game feeling good about your performance. I thought it was a great team performance across the board. They came out, they took care of business. Little shaky at first, but eventually they started to pull away.
Well, I think, again, the inclination is going to be to look at those 52 points, but, right now you hold Tennessee to 14, Youngstown State to 17. Pretty good job by the defense as well. As we head downstairs, Meg Bulger with head coach Dana Holgorsen.
Coach, the rain's slowing down just in time, but it seems like you guys are starting to like second halves and the rain a little bit here.
I guess. I don't know. I tell you, I give Youngstown State credit. They played good. They played hard. We were pretty sloppy for whatever reason, which is going to be good for us to be able to look at it. Way too many penalties. I don't think we played very smart, but we'll be able to learn from it. And, just the goal is to get a week better here moving forward.
Well, we've all seen what Will Greer can do, but the running game really got moving today in multiple directions. Was that something you guys wanted to focus on today?
Well, it was. It's just what Coach Pliny said right there. He's like, I was going to make you guys run the ball because they knew it couldn't cover those receivers, which we know what Will can do. We know what the receivers can do. We got to get the run game going. It was the one aspect that I wasn't happy with last week, and I was really happy with the way we did it today.
All right, well, good luck next week down in North Carolina.
Thank you.
Rob?
Meg, thanks very much, and great work again by Meg Bulger. Great to see her down here as her sister, Katie. We didn't even have a chance to mention that, going into the Hall of Fame in a couple of weeks. Yep. So let's go back down stairs again to Meg, who is standing by with Will Greer.
Well, Will, another big game for you, 4 TDs. Was it something that, that you guys wanted to do today, was get that run game going? Coach Holgorsen said, Bo Pelini even mentioned it to him, about how you guys got that going. Was that something you guys saw a difference in the second half with?
Yeah, no doubt. Anytime that those running backs are doing a really good job right now. Line did a really good job tonight. We want to pound the rock when we can, and they did a great job when they came to play. So it opened up some stuff in the passing game.
And speaking of, the offense, a couple of guys got their first career touchdowns, and it seemed like the sideline was really having a fun time tonight. Was that something nice when, you're working so hard to take a little break from?
Oh, absolutely. Anytime a guy like Dom gets an end zone, he's a great kid. He deserves it. We were really fired up about that one. But, it was a good night. Got to win.
All right. Well, good luck next week.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, guys.
Meg, thanks very much. Dominic Baden, there it is. We're seeing the tail end of his first touchdown. Letty Brown, Alex Sinkfield. Special moments for these guys that they'll never forget.
You'll never forget it. It's always that first one that sticks in your mind. And luckily for these guys, it occurred at home in front of their fans. Again, hopefully family. So a lot of bright spots for West Virginia.
And look at that, 625 yards of total offense, 336 through the air, 289 on the ground. The Mountaineers dominating 52-17. And we'll see in the coming weeks, obviously, but this is a very talented-looking Rasheed West Virginia team.
Very talented. They're going to have to put it all together. It's going to take more than one player at each position to get it done. Tonight they showed a little bit of depth, and that's going to play out as this season goes forward.
West Virginia improved to 2-0 as the Mountaineers defeat Youngstown State 52-17. For Rasheed Marshall, Meg Bulger, our entire AT&T Sportsnet crew, I'm Rob King, thanking you for watching Wild and Wonderful Athletics on AT&T Sportsnet.